Good afternoon. Today we're here to have a special meeting for budget purposes. I believe no decisions will be made today, so from what I understand, it will be more of an overview, our first look at the 2020 budget. So hopefully we can get some questions answered today. So thank you, Mrs. Sinclair, and your staff for all the hard work to ensure this was received by council in time for a thorough review. So I would like to now call the meeting to order. First item on the agenda is for the receipt and adoption of the agenda items for the special council meeting for budget purposes. May I have a mover? Moved by Councillor Long, seconded by Councillor Ferguson. I will now call the question. All those in favor? And it carries unanimously. So moving on, is for council to receive the presentation by staff regarding the 2020 operating budget. May I have a mover and a seconder? Councillor Ferguson, and seconded by Councillor Arneson. All those in favor? Carries unanimously. Mr. Bakken, do you have any comments?
Yes, thank you, Madam Chair. It's important as we begin this process to recognize that we're probably going to make your head hurt, and it's going to probably hurt our heads as well going through this, because this is one of the more complicated budget cycles we've gone through. And in that regard, I wanted to give you some comfort. We're using the same format that we've used previously, but there's some substantive changes in terms of the process that we're looking at. This is almost a pre-budget meeting, if you will, as we go forward. What we've tried to do so far is itemize some of the cost drivers and the revenue opportunities, but we haven't, come up with any firm recommendation in terms of what we should be looking at, because we need to work with council and get some input and provide some information, and in exchange get some facts back, some directions back. I want to be very clear that when you look at the numbers today, they're not indicative of any sort of recommendation. One cannot extrapolate a potential tax increase or decrease, but most certainly a tax increase, from these numbers at this point. It's just too premature. We're going to be focusing on the drivers to explain why we're starting with some of the numbers that we're starting from, to indicate what the cost is just to flip the switch and keep the lights going, to then look at continuing or extending services as community needs to begin to develop, as well as trying to figure out other things such as, well, what about the traditional, supplementary items, service enhancements? What about capital, how those pieces fit together? Our challenge this year in particular is we need some time to work on the capital, because at this point we're still not certain as to what envelope council would like us to work with in regards to that capital. We have some significant demands, cost pressures that we have to address, and we may have to have a longer term budget strategy in terms of going forward if we want to try to smooth out some of the peaks and valleys as we begin to see them. So as you mentioned, no decision today is expected other than to probably meet again, and when that meeting should occur. But to begin to educate and frame some of the challenges we have, as we have this collision where we're seeing increased expenditures, a reduction, in the rate of increase of our revenues, and increasing capital demands as we become a growing area. This is something it's really intended to help us design the framework to go forward, to bring back the budget and to deal with some of the ideas we've come up with and to do it. So I wanted just to reaffirm that we're not looking at anything in terms of a certain percentage at this point. We're going to give you some facts and information, and your feedback will then help us begin to drive it. To give you a bit of a precursor to where we think the answers may lie, we think it's going to depend upon, some service restrictions. That is, perhaps we don't continue to extend services. This is things like programs and initiatives as we once have. We may have to redefine what we consider discretionary and non-discretionary. We may have to then look at things like the capital program. Can we reduce that, or can we defer some of those items going forward, so we get to an area where we think that there is some comfort from council in terms of trying to explain or provide some direction as to the budget. Now, Karen, did you have any preliminary comments before you go driving into it?
Okay, so I have a couple of questions from one. We'll start with Councillor Richter.
Okay. So we're not looking at a 9.7% increase overall?
Only if council requests it. We could go 20, we could go zero. It just depends on the implications on expenditures such as capital programs or the services. I think we're on the because of the collision of the revenue challenges and expense challenges, I think we're going to want to redefine some of the things that we do. We may, or we may have to look at redefining the capital program. For example, traditionally, we've always had a contribution to capital from general revenue. Council has wrestled with this idea of community amenity contributions. We could, I guess, begin to use that tool as a way to provide more, substance to our capital program. The problem is how broadly we define that and what it becomes, because we're concerned that it may also appear simply to be another, another general levy on the population if it's too broad. So those are challenges we look to explore during this these sessions.
Okay, well, I'm just going to state right now for the record, 9.7% is, I'm not supporting it. I don't even think we should be looking at anything over 2% combined capital and operating in this budget. And I don't want to play the game that we usually play, which is, what are you going to cut out? No, I think what we should be doing is giving policy direction to staff right now and saying, we want a 2% overall, period, end of discussion. Go figure out what has to be cut, and let's just cut it. And if it requires service cuts, then I'm sorry. This continuous increase in property taxes is just not sustainable, and certainly not. I mean, last year you've got the numbers here of 2.93 just for the operating or the universal services, and it's up to 4.12. It's doubled. It's not sustainable. We can't do it anymore. So those are my thoughts, and I'd be quite willing to put a motion forward that we just say 2% cap and give it back to staff and let them work with it.
Okay, Councillor Long.
That's an interesting formula. I'm not sure where the 2% would came from, but my comments would be about Mr. Bakken explaining the process here, that this is a preliminary meeting and that we'll be determining whether we meet again or not, but my calendar shows that it's 10:30 next Monday, so that's being confirmed that the next meeting is then, or are we going to discuss that, because some councillors may not be able to make that, or so can we get some certainty on that, Madam Chair?
Mr. Bakken?
I think we should probably discuss not just one date, but future dates, depending upon what happens from today. So my suggestion is that we allow some time towards the end to actually plot one date or two. I mean, it's possible council could simply provide some direction now and we could be done for some time. So, or it may take additional meetings than those that we've actually suggested be added. So I think that's something that you can probably assess more fully once we actually get just the preliminaries out of the way.
Thank you.
Okay, I don't see any other questions, so I suppose we shall begin. I'll turn your mic on. Right here. Welcome.
Testing. Your Worship, members of council, thank you for the opportunity to present this year's budget. It has been a tough one. I agree with Mr. Bakken on that issue. I'll take you through and provide information, and then we can decide on what next steps are. So this is tentatively the schedule of meetings that we have, meetings or reports, with today being the draft operating budget presentation and discussion. And then we hope to bring you on the 27th, which is next Monday, the capital, to tie it all together. And I imagine the next discussion on the 3rd will bring the two together, is the hope. And then we have our public consultation, which is the open houses, bring back the results, the 5-year financial plan. This is just to give a sense of sort of if you work backwards from the tax due date when we have to have everything done. So the taxes starting from the bottom typically go out the 3rd week in May. And then we have to have 2 meetings for rates. So that's April 20th and April 6th. And we work backwards and we could be quite squeezed in the middle if we delay too much, but we definitely do have some room built in. These are just a highlight of the on the user fee side, we're starting with user fee utilities of the revenues and this expenditure components that we'll be talking about as we move through the presentation. You can see other than user fee revenue, there's other user fees that happen, sale of things, connection fees. There's user fee from growth. There's salary and wage contracts, special contracts, i.e. solid waste. There's regional district costs for all of water, sewer, and solid waste. Maintenance contracts, regular ongoing planted area maintenance and inspection programs, dispatch. We have equipment and vehicle costs, asset management, and then programs is a new category added this year to have a separate discussion about. This is just a pictorial view of the cost drivers, the revenue and cost drivers. So you can see on the user pay utility side of things, the largest other than property taxes, the largest revenue sale of services, followed by estimated new growth. Debt repayment contributions is typically DCCs, so money coming into the budget from the DCC reserves in order to pay debt. Transfers from own funds and investment income. Then on the bottom half, on the universal services, the largest expense category you'll see is salary and wages. On the user pay utility side, it is the regional district charges. So that is the water, GVWD, GVS&DD, and the solid waste, which is composed of the tipping fees. Then we have service and maintenance contracts. Salary and wages comes in third, and on down the road of the normal costs that you'll see, and we'll talk about a little bit more as we go. So specifically for 2020, this is highlighting some of the challenges that we're having. So on the GVS and DD side, you might recall last year, we had a large increase on the GVS and DD side. That's the sewer, the sewage liquid waste as charged by the Metro Vancouver. It went up, quite a bit. It went from 7.3 million to 9.3 million, which was a 27.9% increase last year. This year, it's actually rolling back. It's a minus 3%. So they're rolling it back 3% this year from last year's level, which probably means because the large increase from last year was predominantly debt, that probably means they've firmed up some of their debt and they've got better rates than they thought, and they were able to roll some of that back. So that's an area that has been going kind of up and down for us of recent. GVWD is water, which is impacted by both the increasing water prices as well as the increasing in volumes of water that we have to purchase, and it is tied into how we're dealing with our wells, whether or not we're expanding or contracting the wells or holding them frozen. And then we have the metro tipping fees, which are going from $1.08 a tonne to $1.13 a tonne. And then for the rest of the period, 21 through 24, they're going up by $7 each year. So that will impact us. Salary and wage contracts, we have QP is in place until 2020, when negotiations will start up again. We have the operating impact of township capital and community development. Actually, I should be flipping here. I'll give you the highlights, which is the cost of when we finish new capital projects or when we inherit capital from the development community, we have to add to our operating budget the cost of operating that. So if we add a new park, we have to add costs to water it, fertilize it, and mow it. That's one of the easiest ones. And as Tab Buckner likes to say, when you put in a new park, you have to feed it right away. Otherwise, it doesn't do well. We have a commitment to infrastructure, continued diligence in providing funding levels to support both our asset maintenance side, which is the commitment to infrastructure on the operating side, which is maintaining our maintenance programs, as well as on the capital side, from the operating budget, we contribute to the capital plan annually to keep the capital program up. And then this final category is the new one that I spoke about to do with programs, commitment to maintain established service levels. On the sewer, water and sewer side, it's not very large, relatively speaking, but I'm maintaining the presentations to be very similar, considered a warm-up for the universal services side. I'll explain it a little bit more when we get to universal services or the slide coming up. So GVWD, another thing that's impacting our water budget this year is an agreement that we entered into last year with Metro Vancouver and GVWD to put away money. We have a payment coming up, and in 2023 or 2024, it's going to be about $4 million for the Jericho Reservoir Phase 2. They're not exactly sure what year it's going to start, but they've given us an opportunity to lock in the rates of that we're going to contribute as long as we pay it on a payment plan. So we're doing that, and this is year two of that agreement. So it's $818,000 we're adding to the water budget each year until it builds up to that $4 million level. So this is year two of that program. This is just a summary.
Sorry, I just have a question.
Sure.
I do have a question here from Councillor Richter. Now, would you like to wait until the end of your, or like how would we proceed? Okay, so Councillor Richter, would you like to...
Yeah, I just want to highlight on the previous slide when you're looking at the issues and challenges, the regional costs coming out of GVS and DD, GVWD, as well as solid waste. Those are, you're just scratching the tip of the iceberg. There's going to be substantial increases in the next 3 years. And we will be feeling the effect of that. So I'm just flagging that. because that will impact our budgets for the next 3 years as well, too, because of the increases that are coming on the metro side. With regards to that last point, commitment to maintain established service levels, why? Are rollbacks possible?
They're always possible. It becomes a decision about the trade-offs. So these are programs where it's not that we haven't been doing this work. The departments have been doing this work. I mean, they've been doing it in more of a general, from a bucket that's more of a general bucket, like labor, materials, and supplies. And some of these programs are really taking on a life of themselves, or without thinking of a better way to describe it, where the departments can actually capture it now. A really good example is the homeless cleanup. You recall, I think it was 2 years ago, so it's probably before the new councillors, they won't remember, but we had a discussion about homeless camp cleanups. They were just kind of starting 2 years ago in the community, and we were seeing that we were really putting pressure on our regular budgets to address the homeless camp cleanups. And programs like that, we've always been doing them, but we've been trying to do them sort of off the side of our desk, which for the operations department is in lieu of something else in our operations, so they're doing it. So now they've been able to capture some of these programs and identify them, which helps them to, number one, budget for them more adequately, and number two, be accountable to those programs. If they say that they have a program of this amount of money for homeless camp cleanups, then as the year goes by, they can stick to that, and they can see at the end of the year how they did. So it's more sort of measurable and accountable, and it also helps to put staff out to work on those programs.
Okay.
To identify. So it's always
that.
A trade-off.
Yeah. Yeah. Oh, I get that, but what I'm saying here, this commitment to maintain established service levels.
Correct.
So where is that coming from? Because that's basically saying we don't want to drop anything.
Yeah, so
we want to keep everything exactly the way it is now.
Absolutely. It's coming from me, from the perspective of the budget comes forward with with no assumption of reducing or increasing service levels. So I wouldn't want to assume that we're going to reduce service levels to take care of anything. I'd keep it at established service levels, and then we have that discussion here.
Okay. So that is open for discussion.
Absolutely.
We can change the established service levels.
Yes.
Okay. Thank you.
Councillor Ferguson.
I want to just comment that what Councillor Richter said as well is, I know she sits on the board, but I'm on the utilities committees, and I know that the region is planning for growth. They've been planning for growth, and they're also upgrading and maintaining major infrastructure, which means this major sewage treatment plants within the region. Iona, North Vancouver's got a new one in. We have Langley as well as within the region, their pipes and other ones. So they are, as Councillor Richter has indicated, they have a major capital budget coming up over the next, I think, 7 years or something, and the years vary, as we all know, from an accounting point of view, and they are doing everything they can. I know the board had some questions as well to make sure the impact is spread over a number of years, but I'm not sure if you have any more comments regarding that, but it's important for us at the council to be aware of that.
For sure. One comment I'd like to make in support of what both Councillor Richter and yourself have said. So while they have rolled back the sewer and drainage levy this year by $219,000, just as a precursor to what has just been said, for 2021, they are adding $1.3 million, then $1.6 million, and then $1.1 million. So it does go up and down a little bit, but clearly beyond this year, which is a rollback, the next 4 years are going to be high. That's in the area of 15% per year. So it's absolutely true. And you're going to see when we get into the detail on the sewer budget that even though that would have the decrease that we had this year would have allowed us to come in a little bit possibly lower than normal on the sewer, we're trying to maintain a 1.5% user fee increase just to keep it incremental. Experience has shown that taxpayers like something that's consistent and predictable. So we're keeping it incremental, knowing that the next year something large is coming, and we're taking a step towards that, knowing that if we levy a little bit more this year, we can do capital projects with it. So I'll explain that a little bit more when we get there, but I hear you loud and clear on that, sewer.
Now, this is not something that, and those folks listening, this is not something the region in itself decided. There was an edict pressed by both the federal and provincial government for new environmental standards. And those environmental standards have to be met by a deadline, and they also have to have an impact on environmental measures throughout the region. A lot of people would argue that that those standards are a little bit higher than perhaps they are already doing, because we're already doing a very good job to an excellent job. But the bar keeps getting raised, and it's expensive for the taxpayers. And I just wanted to bring that to your attention as well.
That's correct. Much of this has been passed down from the province.
Yeah. Councillor Richter has another question.
Yeah, just to follow up on that, yes, the federal government has imposed levels of service in terms of treatment requirements on the sewer side, but Metro has voluntarily, of its own choice, upped those even higher to tertiary levels. So Metro does have a say in this, and Metro is driving those costs as well.
No other questions.
So now I have a slide for each of these. We've already done this one. This is the salary and wages. So you can see the percentage increase in salary and wages over the previous year is 2%. That's the contract increases on the first line. Second line, we have steps and increments as people move through. And as we have younger staff joining the township, or new staff, not necessarily younger, sometimes you can join when you're 50, they go through the steps of their pay band. So that's what the steps and increments is about. And we have one extra day in the year in 2020, which is 261 to 262 days. And while it doesn't look like a lot here, it can add up. So it's. I had a question about it on the universal services, because it's 0.19%. And then other is just a catch-all, which catches other contracts. And that's that one, smallest category there. So here's the impact on the user fees of salaries. This is the operating impact of Township Capital. We've talked about it a little bit, and these are in full dollars. They're not thousands of dollars. They're full dollars. So on the sewer side, we have to add about $220,000 to the operating base to take care of sewer assets that we've either built or in this case built. And on the water side, $51,296. And you can see on the sewer side, it's mainly driven by three lift stations: the Aldergrove, the 266 and 24th Street, and then the 33rd A and 196th. Those are the large lift stations that are coming online that will have operating costs associated. And on the water side, it's the booster station at Brookswood Heights. And that would be a combination of labor, contract, materials and supplies, all of the expenditure categories. And on the development side, this is a full number as well. So this is 6,593, so it's not a lot coming online.
I do have one more question from Councillor Richter.
To the sewer and water, the operating impact there, the 200, that slide.
Yeah.
How sure are we that we're going to get contract bids in that will pertain to this? And I ask this again because Metro is running into that problem. They're putting contracts out and people are not meeting the expected bid. They're going way above.
I would say, just to start, and then I'll turn it over to Mr. Safi if he has anything to add, that I believe it's based on the most recent construction of a similar like asset is how we pick up the operating costs. Would that be fair?
That's correct, and Councillor Richter is quite right. It is quite possible that based on market conditions, there aren't any bids, or sometimes they're not competitive. In other words, we have just one bid for certain capital construction works, in which case we have to rethink the timing or the process to acquire those assets.
Okay, so a corollary question then is, how essential are each of these projects? So if we put a request for proposals out there and the bids come in higher than we anticipate, are we in a position to say, thank you very much, we're just going to withdraw our RFP and not do the project this year? Or do we have to do these projects this year?
Madam Chair, these are, for the most part, relating to development and growth. And as such, the capital construction costs are covered in the DCC program. So they are somewhat time sensitive, but we do have the opportunity in some cases. I can't quite determine categorically, definitively which ones. For example, I think the Alder Grove one, we might have a bit more time in terms of the immediacy of development applications as opposed to the Brookswood one at 196 and 33A, which is more, I guess the need for which is more imminent than the Alder Grove one, just off the top of my head. So we do have some discretion with some of them, but some of the other ones, development is actually awaiting the completion of these works before we can issue permits, building permits. So.
Okay, thank you.
And this is the same thing, but for development. Our commitment to infrastructure from operating funds. So water, sewer, solid waste, this is just a reminder that we do have an operating amount of money that we send over to the capital program each year. And for water, it's $781,000. For sewer, it's $243,000. And for solid waste, it's $50,000, which is to replace broken or damaged carts. On the sewer one, I'd like to mention that quite unique to sewer is that we also have a budgeted contribution to the sewer capital works reserve. So the other areas don't have a budgeted contribution, but sewer does. And I'm not sure where that historically came from. It could quite easily be converted to a contribution to capital, which would make it 2.243. So there is another 2 million in addition to the contribution to capital for sewer. Yep.
Councillor Richter.
So if we don't know where this operating transfer to the sewer capital works reserve came from, like $2 to $3 million, that's quite a bit. Why do we keep doing it?
Well, we don't know where it initiated, but we do know that we need it. So if it wasn't, my point being is it's not consistent with the other areas that have a contribution to capital. If we were going to change it to be consistent, we would get rid of the transfer to sewer and we would just convert it to a contribution to capital.
Okay, yeah. And then it could be used for sewer then, but not
then
necessarily?
No, it would be used in the very same way. It would just be coming from a different funding source. I just didn't want to give the impression that water had $781,000 and sewer only had $243,000 because they do have this other source that's not common to the other areas. That's unique.
Well, it's interesting to have an ongoing expense like that, and we don't know why or where it came from.
Well, we don't know what the history of why it got split into having the two pieces, but we do know that we need it every year. I'll say that for sure. We do know that for the capital program, we do need it. Yeah. So commitment to maintain existing service levels through programs. This is the topic that I think we'll spend some time on today. So for water and sewer, it's relatively small. And as I mentioned earlier, this is an area where the departments, the staff have started to really develop programs that they can identify and tag money to it and cause it to be more accountable in terms of how they spend the money, how they deploy the work. And I think it will be good for the community as we move forward. As anything, when you shine a light on something, it can magnify it, and you see what you really need. So on the universal services side, it's quite a bit more significant than this, and we'll have some further discussion when we get there. The summary of budget changes is very similar to what you have in the memo. In the area, this is water, sewer, and solid waste at the top of the three columns. You can see the salaries that we've already gone through. The first four categories are the salaries that we talked about. The next line, regional costs, is the water and liquid waste that we talked about. And then we have the waste organics collection and disposal contract is going up also in 2020, the four areas. Waste collection and disposal, organics collection and disposal. We have the operating impact of development and capital, which we just looked at. And we have a Jericho interest payment from phase one of Jericho, which is the principal's being paid from DCCs, but the interest is being paid from the water user fees. And then we have the Jericho prepayment plan agreement for phase two, and that's the $818,000 that we're putting in each year until it builds up. I think it's 2023, builds up to the $4,091,000 balloon payment that we have to make over 3 years. Then we have administrative overhead, which is a charge to the utilities for some of the administrative costs in universal services, so accounts payable, budgeting, human resources, information technology. This is trying to recognize that even though we do that work in universal services, it does impact the utilities. They benefit from it.
I do have a couple questions.
Sure.
Councillor Woodward.
Yeah, thanks. I just had a question about the additional day, because I know I've seen that on almost every slide. There's an additional day, but I just wanted to ask in terms of the how the salaries work. If I make $100,000 a year, I don't get paid more because there's an extra day in it. So why is that happening here?
The reason it's happening is because all of our salaries are based on an hourly rate and a number of hours in the year. So the pay grades for everybody are $25 an hour, $25.61 an hour, whatever it happens to be, times, for exempt staff, 957 and a half hours. And for non-exempt staff, it would be, I think it's 2,100 and something. Recognizing the exempt work 7.5 hours, QP works 8, and it's very right down to the hour. So it's not an annual salary. I hear what you're saying. It's not specified.
Not an annual salary, the
not
way
an annual salary.
The private sector might think of it. I've never seen this in the private sector, so it doesn't.
Yeah,
make, so it's just it's a public sector thing.
It's definitely a public sector thing.
Okay.
And
this is one, again, I think one of the great examples where I do not envy your position here at the township, and that sounds pretty torturous. I can't imagine what it's actually like to manage that. I did have a question about user fees versus property tax growth. So here, you're showing that we're generating more revenue from user fees based on growth, which is reducing some of the increased burden. Is that one way of putting
correct.
It?
Okay. Yep.
Which surprises me a little bit, because if we have more people, we're going to be using more water and using more sewer. So how is it that we're benefiting from growth and user utilities?
It's just it just calculates or quantifies the number of new units coming online. So definitely we will have more costs, which is, in a perfect world, if growth did pay for itself, you wouldn't have anything other than this category. That would be perfect. But it is recognizing all the new units that come online for water and for sewer.
You're anticipating that, because but it's a negative number. So revenue increases, including excess user fee from growth, is an offset number, 674, and then you get at 459. Maybe I'm not reading that correctly.
Oh, sorry. Yeah.
So I'm still not sure from that answer. Again, you need to try me again. Is that how you're seeing a decrease in the cost burden if you're increasing your demand?
So the line that you're referencing, the 674,
yeah,
that needs a little bit more of an explanation from the line 2 down, which is the user pay utility revenue from growth, which is the one I thought you were talking about.
Okay. They both have from growth on them, so I didn't...
Yeah, and they are both from growth.
I didn't differentiate, but if you can, that'd be great.
Sure. So the revenue increases, including excess user fee revenue from growth, so that's a bit of a mixture, that pot right there, is for the last 2 or 3 years, we've been experiencing more than our 2% that we've been estimating in the area of growth in the utilities. So this year, we're right-sizing it, bringing it in to the budget so that we're not levying additional user fee to raise the money that growth is clearly doing for us on the user pay utility side. So that's probably 2 or 3 years worth of growth pulled in this year, excess growth, to start with as a starting point. The line 2 below it is what we anticipate for 2020 to be the growth. So we're using 2% as an estimate of how many units we expect to come online in 2020.
So that does confuse me, because if more units are coming online, they're going to be paying the utility, but then they're using a proportionate amount of service. So I still don't see how we're...
So on the water side, it might be better explainable that the water side is a huge portion of it is residential, which is a flat fee. So it kind of operates like a flat fee. It's not cubic meter to cubic meter. One cubic meter charged is for the one cubic meter used. It's more of a flat fee, which...
I think that's close enough. That answers that. And that's different than the 2018 adjustment that I saw in some of the other content, where you estimated growth at a certain amount in 2018. It didn't turn out, and now we're paying for that in 2020 budget. That could happen here as well?
It could.
In subsequent years, as opposed to it being a nice number this year?
Yep.
It also sometimes works out to be a...
It actually is on the solid waste. It's back a little bit on the solid waste.
Yes, right. There it is. There's another example of that. So once in a while, it oscillates between a positive number and a negative number.
Correct.
And then the 2018 estimate, I'll ask you about that when you get there.
Sure.
Okay, thanks.
Councillor Whitmarsh.
Yes, thank you. I just wanted to continue on with that discussion that Councillor Woodward was asking. The number for revenue increases, in the example of water, 674, sewer, 392, did I understand that to be then this is like a catch-up year for... sort of underestimating the growth from previous years?
Is that's correct. Some of it is, not the whole 674. There's other revenue sources in there as well. There's an increase of $33,000 for a secondary suite revenue. So there's a few different kinds of revenue in that revenue increases, including excess user fees.
Okay. So, and then the 459 number in that first column is the 2% that we anticipate growth to be as we move forward. And
correct.
So as we move into subsequent budget years, the 674 number will be significantly smaller because we've done the catch-up this year.
Yeah.
Is that
That's correct. We did a little bit of a catch-up last year. We were conservative on our catch-up, so we right-sized it this year because we could tell that it was going to stick. We are always conservative about that.
So the increased use of water, sewer, solid waste as a result of growth, that's been built into, that's part of the budget requests in earlier, is it not? The expense side?
This is looking at all the non-discretionary asks, and we do apply the expected revenue from growth to the non-discretionary costs before we move forward to add things like service enhancements. I don't know if that answers your question.
Well, I guess I'm wondering, this gives us the revenue that we're getting from growth, but there's obviously increased usage as a result of growth. And is that built into is that showing up in this 813 number? But that's a regional cost. So where is the increased growth showing up?
The
increased usage?
Usage would just be in all the categories.
Spread throughout them.
Yeah.
I see.
It would be that we have to deploy more labor, we have more contracts, we have more materials and supplies that are utilized in providing the service to the consumer.
Okay. Yeah. So my last question is on the administration overhead. Are these new positions to help this?
No, this recognizes that, for example, I'm up here doing the budget for the whole township, but my salary hits universal services only, as does accounts payable and human resources and information technology. So this is trying to recognize that, and it's approximately 6%. It's trying to push 6% of our costs and the different managers in different departments, everybody here probably,
right.
Trying to push our costs over into the utilities, recognizing that we all exist here for the whole township, not just universal services. So we're just, this is how they bear a burden of that administration.
Right. But now, was that, for example, the 6%, was that not done in previous years?
It's every year. Yeah.
This is an increase though.
Correct. Yeah.
Because of just growth, and as we grow and have more to do, that's why we have this increase.
Yeah.
But we should be cautious because there would be increased costs even if there was no growth. So if you have a zero growth situation, you will still see your costs rise. And that's going to be because of contractual commitments, potential uses implications, and other issues. The question, I fear the discussion is going into one of, well, does growth actually pay for itself? And the answer is, in some ways it does, in some ways it doesn't. Overall, it's probably going to be a loss. The most efficient municipality probably has no residents because you have a lot less service calls, but you ignore the purpose for which you're there. So the important thing, I think, is to steer away from the growth paying for growth or not paying for growth. It's what are the cost drivers going to be? In some situations, adding incremental users, such as the water fund with the levies, may actually exceed the rate of the other increases. In other situations, such as sewer, because of the increased costs and infrastructure, you'll likely see in any given year that the costs per user exceed that we're recovering or collecting.
Okay, so yeah, that's helpful, and I wasn't wanting to move down the path of growth paying for growth, but I was just trying to understand the administration overhead versus the salary and wages up top. So I understand the salary and wages up top are those that are specifically dedicated to water, sewer, solid waste.
Correct.
Administration is those that have a periphery connection to it, are involved in it, but aren't directly only from water, sewer, solid waste, but they play a role, so therefore we have an administration overhead.
Correct. The rule of thumb is if we can clearly identify a cost, even if we can clearly identify it, we will capture it on the user pay side. So you might see, you'll see a little bit later in this presentation, you'll see a financial analyst funded 100% from utilities, which is removed from this calculation because it can be identified that it works 100% on utilities. So we try to capture those items that are 100% utilities in utilities. And this represents everything else. And I should have mentioned all of you and Mark and everybody.
Everybody else. Yep. Okay, that's helpful. Thank you.
Yep. Councillor Richter.
Just some follow-up questions. So while we're on this administration overhead, How is it that there's more administration overhead than there is actual employee costs? That doesn't make sense.
Yeah, it's a percentage of all of the total expenditure budget. So it's just a percentage of a much larger number than just the salaries. The salaries in utilities is not as large as it is on the universal services side, but it's because it's a percentage of all costs, not just salaries, it tends to be significant.
Okay, so is 6% a reasonable allocation to these
it's
services?
It's something that should be looked at every few years. Interestingly, in both Abbotsford and Surrey, where I come from, it was 6% in both of those, and I surmise that that's probably just because municipalities share with each other. But it seems to have been 6% forever and a day. So it is something that should be looked at. And it's not exactly, it's usually 5.71 and 6.03. It's in the realm of 6%, but it should be looked at probably once every five years.
Okay. So this is a cost accounting measure, basically.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah.
All right. Going back to the question that Councillor Woodward asked with regards to salaries and your answer that they're based on an hourly rate.
Yeah.
Does this include the exempt positions as well?
Yes.
Okay. Now, are we required to do that by law or by contract?
It's just the way the contract is right now. I don't know. Is Shannon, is it a law or is, yeah, Shannon?
It's not a law per se. Those are things that are negotiated, and the practice historically in the industry has always been to simply mirror what the collective agreement processes are. Could that be done differently? Yes, but most of the exempt staff are under an employment contract, so it would mirror that language.
Okay, because the point that Councillor Woodward raised about the private sector, yeah, if you get a salary, you get a salary. You don't get an hourly wage.
Right, you get a monthly or an annual.
Yeah, so maybe we should switch over to private sector practices, if there's nothing preventing us from doing that.
Well, we certainly could, and it's something we've aspired to. The challenge comes into some of the, and I don't want to get into a comparison of private versus public sector, far from it, some of the other compensation that we could not consider, such as productivity bonuses or performance bonuses that are missing. One of the challenges in the industry is, because of the public sector nature, is that pay for performance becomes an issue and it becomes very complicated. So that's something that we've tended to avoid entering into.
Well,
frankly,
I actually don't think we need that, because we've got very secure jobs that pay well with lots of benefits, which is way more attractive than some private sector jobs. So I don't think pay for performance is needed.
Yeah.
But looking at salaries versus wages maybe is something we should be doing.
But that's what I'm trying to articulate, that the overall compensation package is different elements that one has to compare. And you're quite right, there's things such as pensions, and there's things such as, I guess, security of provisions. But there's also the other parts that make it a difficult package to compare. And your question related back to the, I guess, percentage, could it be a flat salary or a flat rate? It could be. It just wouldn't be within the norms of the industry, and it would be something that would just cause an additional challenge, and it probably could be implemented over a number of years.
Okay. Well, maybe that's something we could look at and start with the exempt positions. The Jericho interest rate payment, I just had a question about that. Is that interest payment included in the 0.6% external debt payments cited in under Universal Services?
No, because this is internal debt. We're actually funding this from water surplus, but because it was in the DCC program and developers are supposed to pay for it, we've borrowed internally and we're paying it back using the similar mechanisms to external debt, but we're paying back our water capital works reserve for it. So it's not part of our external debt. All right, have I made it down there? I stopped on administration. Rate stabilization, this has to do, this 579 in the middle column, has to do with my comments earlier about sewer and what's going to be happening in the next 4 years with sewer. So if we had left the budget as it was without that 579 transfer to reserves, we would have had a rollback of the sewer increase for this year. But we've kept it consistent and predictable and modest at 1.5%. To try and recognize that we are heading into a period of time where we're going to have some fairly large increases. And this just starts to build up the base so that next year is not as bad. And we can use the funds that will be derived from transferring that to the rate to the reserve. We can use that next year to help moderate the increase. So, for example, if 579 equaled 5%, Next year, if we had a 15% increase, we could draw from the reserve to moderate it and bring it in gradually, so it wouldn't be a huge hit to the utility all at once. That's the goal with that. On the solid waste side, this is on the solid waste side. Let me think. Oh, yes, sorry. The solid waste, the rates are set for a full 5 years. So the hope is that you have your cart rates and your base fee, and they don't change for 5 years. So in the first year, we have a budgeted transfer to reserve because the rate set generates revenue that we have a little bit of excess, we transfer to the reserve. And for the next 4 years, as we don't increase the rate but costs go up, we start to draw down that reserve so that we can keep the rate even for people, for the citizens, for 5 years. That's the idea on that one. Any questions about that? And this is the this is just a breakdown of the programs that we talked about earlier, the 140,000 and the 250 for water and sewer. So these are some of the areas where water and sewer is needing, has identified they're needing to build up those resources more. They're not quite as descriptive as in the universal services side, but nonetheless, they're areas that they've identified for fairly significant increases to these utilities. And
I do have a question from Councillor Richter.
Sure.
The title of this slide says program increases to maintain existing service levels. Right. What if we don't maintain existing service levels? What if we decide we can't afford to do that anymore? Do we have to do these program increases?
That decision is definitely a decision that you as a council have the right to make for sure.
Okay.
Right now, the staff have been doing this work. This is the corner of the desk part where it's been hampering their other programs. So they're bringing it forward and identifying that in order to maintain existing service levels, this is what I need.
Okay. So are they going to justify to us why we need all these additional staff?
This is mostly auxiliary labor. So we can bring back that. I can mark it down and we can bring back something to the Q&A.
Which we certainly should do, but to be clear, this is additional hours, not additional staff.
I mean,
they could be done by existing staff, but the question is, what do these additional hours deliver in terms of maintaining the existing service levels?
I thought it was dollars, not hours.
This is dollars, but I think what Mr. Backen's trying to say is these aren't positions. It's auxiliary wages, so it's auxiliary, just casual wages. A little bit more than casual, it's auxiliary, but it's not RFTs or RPTs.
Okay. But I guess the question I'm really asking is, what if we just didn't hire these people? What would happen to the service levels then? Would we be putting anything in significant jeopardy or creating safety issues? Maybe we're doing stuff we don't need to be doing is the question I'm asking.
Right. The source control program is one that's sort of self-descriptive. It's really important in the sewer utility, but I'd have to defer to operations staff to comment on the other areas.
Okay. Thank you.
Councillor Woodward.
Yeah, I just want to combine this one with the previous one. So if you could show me the previous one. So I'm going to try to understand here. So contract and steps, those are in-house union contract labor or employees for a simplistic term. Is that what that is? So that's either increases in position or increases in what?
It's increases in, it's a 2% economic increase on all staff and wages, all salary and wages.
So that's what that is.
Okay, regular full-time, regular part-time, auxiliary, casual. Yeah.
Okay. So again, I apologize. I mean, I sort of feel a bit bad for people that have, gone through 20 budgets. I haven't gone through 20 budgets. So the difference between contract and steps increments, if you could.
Sure. Contract increases the increase that comes about as a result of the negotiations with the union contract, and any increases that are granted towards exempt staff. And the steps and increments is a pay band. So when an employee, for example, we have Carm, who's our new manager of financial planning, she starts at a certain level, and as she's here for a certain number of months, she moves her way through the pay bands of that position. So when she starts, she might be on the lower end, and when she finishes, she'll be on
the lower. So then if you go back to the next slide, then it'll make sense where I'm going, at least to me it does. So in the next one here, then under water, for example, based on Mr. Backen's comments, auxiliary indicates contract or external staff. Is that?
Auxiliary indicates positions where the person is not a regular full-time or regular part-time person.
And not to be, you know, too cow, but those people can be let go without any consequences. Is that too simplistic again?
At the casual level, it's probably true, but I believe, Shannon, would you say that's true?
So that's at-will labor, essentially. Okay, so that helps. So I just to clarify again so I understand what's occurring here. So the previous slide, those increases are occurring if we add zero more residents.
With the,
right? we could consume,
if we do nothing to the labor force,
yeah,
yes.
We consume exactly the same quantity of water we consumed last year. We're still incurring those increases. These ones here are specific to having more residents consuming more water, requiring the maintenance of more infrastructure. Is that too, again, too simplistic?
What I'm trying to get to
is that this 0.61 underwater is specific to growth. Is that too simplistic?
I think it's accurate, but I don't think it's necessarily just for the future. I think it's recognizing the growth that we've gone through and trying to catch up and provide ourselves a level that will take us into the future. So it's a bit of both.
So, because if you need more hours to maintain existing service levels, that indicates to me you have more work to do because you have more residents.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
So this would be, again, I'm just not trying, the nuances don't necessarily matter at this point, but like that is essentially a growth number.
It can be residents. It can also be what Councillor Richter and Councillor Ferguson talked about on the metro side. It could be that certain standards, we are hit with sometimes standards from the province as well, especially in the areas of water and sewers, higher bars that we have to live up to and more inspections that we have to do on certain items. And I don't want to get too far in the weeds because I'll let you guys all know that I don't know what I'm talking about in that area. But that it's a bit of both. It's not any one thing. Definitely it
they
could be
maintain existing and required service levels.
And required, yeah.
Okay, so you go back to the previous slide again. So that 141 underwater, previous one.
Am I going the wrong way? I'll be okay.
Yeah, that 141 underwater, that would come out of the 674 in all practical terms? Because if I'm attributing the 141 to growth.
No, so the 674 is a done, is it?
It's done, but yeah. Okay, so then maybe 459 then, just to get it right. So
if
459
no more-
minus the 151, that would be more accurate in terms of growth, the cost to actual growth, because we're hiring more people, more hours are necessary to help with the fact that we have more residents. So the 459 is not really the offset, it's the 459 plus the more people we need.
459 is recognizing the growth in revenue that we're going to get, and the other item recognizes to some degree the amount of additional costs that we'll incur. But some of those costs are also retroactive.
For residents that are already here, have a certain expectation, we add, say, 100 more residents, we're going to need these more hours of people to service everything. That 459, it's not, the offset is much lower if we add those additional people. I just want to make sure I understand what's going on.
And those people. So if probably because the and only because we look at the growth number in relationship to the non-discretionary, if we add, I don't know what the best way of saying it, either we won't require the 5.01 user fee increase that I'm going to talk about in a second.
Probably getting pretty academic.
It's getting pretty...
Yeah, it's getting pretty academic. But I think here, just understand clarity, that the growth offset is a nice number here this year for water, but it's less nice if you say we've got to hire a bunch more hours of labor.
Yeah, it just helps to fund them.
Okay,
so
then you go back to the next one, just to wrap this up here. So these ones, I mean, these are currently assumed. We would have to make a motion to pull these out. These are already in the number that's presented as part of the budget.
No, it's not.
It's not.
No, and I should clarify, normally, in a normal year where these numbers aren't as large as they are this year, they would be part of the non-discretionary base. So we would have just had some increases in the materials, maintenance, and service contracts and some other areas that would have been large, and then you might have asked the question, why is that number so large? And we would break it down, and we'd see some of these programs coming online. So we've taken the tact of separating it out so that you can see it, But this is the staff, I think, and Raman would agree, this is non-discretionary. They would consider this non-discretionary work, and only from the perspective of its to maintain existing service levels, because that's our goal. So it's if we want to maintain existing service levels, this is non-discretionary. If we want to reduce the service levels, this could become more discretionary.
That was my last question. So that 0.61 is not included in the increase on the previous slide.
It's not included.
So if you don't hear from council on this further, these people will not be added. We will not be maintaining existing service levels.
Correct.
And that's why we need to know what happens.
So I would like to make sure that that's clarified for me on slides where you're showing, because I made the assumption that these people were a part of that. So now I'm glad I've asked.
Right.
That if you don't hear back from us, maybe we're making assumptions that these people are getting added to maintain service levels. Because it doesn't say necessarily that it's not part of that number.
No,
so if you could clarify on future slides that if we don't actually do something and increase the increase from the 4 to the 4.61 or 4.64, that these people are not going to be added and that we're specifically not maintaining existing service levels. If you can make that 100% absolutely clear from here on, I'd appreciate that. Okay. Thanks.
And, oops. I should say, too, that the user fee utilities are being presented in a slightly different way because they're not as much of a challenge. We are going to take you through to the end, which would be the recommended or draft user fee increases if we get there. They're still totally up for discussion, but we have presented them in a more contiguous fashion than when we get to the universal services. You'll still have all the pieces. Yeah. Yeah.
I do have a question from Councillor Richter, or a comment.
It's a comment. Just to go back to the question that I asked you at the opening about where this commitment to maintain established service levels comes from what I gathered from your answer is that basically this is an assumption for budgeting purposes only, right?
Well, it's an assumption when we prepare the budget, and it's the marching orders that staff operate under, is that they don't want to let service levels drop, because if they let service levels drop, you hear about it. Planted area maintenance is a great.
Oh, okay, but it hasn't been justified to me what happens if service levels drop. That's the question I'm trying to get at, which is why we need to understand if we don't add these positions, what happens. Like, is there a major fallout from not doing it?
I'll defer to Raman.
The answer, I guess the quick answer, Madam Chair, is yes. There are various types of services that are being discussed, some of which, I guess, or one of which was the one that Ms. Sinclair just alluded to, and that's planted area maintenance. That, I guess, is not critical, but is one that council will hear about very soon after the service levels do drop, if in fact that was going to be the case. There are other areas of, I guess, service being provided that are more critical in nature in terms of, say, snow clearance or cases where we have liability, safety, public safety issues, health and safety, whether it's maintaining our facilities, whether it's maintaining boulevards, trails, etc. Those are a bit more challenging to reduce the service levels of because of the public health and safety implications.
Yeah, and those I can certainly buy. I mean, snow clearing, absolutely, after what we went through this past week. But I guess what I'm getting at is maintaining the existing service levels is not something that council has ordered. Maintaining the existing service levels is something that staff would like to see reflected in the budget, but it hasn't been directed by council.
That's not quite right. The service levels are actually set by council, previous councils in previous years, in terms of what they expect, and I guess planted area maintenance was the example that was used. Those levels were created through discussions or through policy directives of the previous councils. You're quite right to say then that staff would operate under that policy directive until there's a change. Can council make that change? They certainly can. They could certainly say, again, using the example of planted area maintenance, don't weed or cut three times a year, do it once per year and take those savings. Those are examples. Those questions, I think, are very important in terms of some of the general revenue issues that we're facing, because there's all sorts of things that are needing discussion, such as the amount of time spent cleaning up homeless camps or whatever else may derive from that. Those sorts of things, I think, are good examples of things that are. We consider them non-discretionary, but they're things that they could have some service level adjustments. But on these, I think, because we're focusing on water and sewer, Raman, are you able to elaborate upon any of the requirements for these? So, for example, are these driven by government regulations, requirements, volume? Is there anything that you can help? Or should we simply come back to elaborate on the explanation or rationale as to why these are considered to be non-discretionary in terms of their classification?
Yes, I think if Council wishes to have a bit more in-depth discussion and analysis about the various items that go into that, it should be provided at a future date as opposed to now.
Yeah, and I think we have to, because maintaining the existing service levels is what's driving these significant tax or budget increases, which are going to translate into tax increases. So maybe we need to start questioning the existing service levels, and that's what I'm doing. I can certainly justify adding a utilities operations auxiliary technical staff person if that is going to translate into some sort of public safety risk if we don't do it. But if it's just because we need that to do something extra, then we should be questioning whether or not we should be doing the extra, because we can't continue to go on. Like 9.7%, it's too much.
Okay, so Councillor Long.
Madam Chair, you know, there's certain council continually repeats a line over and over again that council doesn't want to maintain existing services. That's just not an accurate statement. That might be her opinion or that council's opinion, and certainly they're entitled to it. But if you repeat it 10 or 15 times every 10 minutes, staff are going to get the idea, and so are the public, that we're going to start reducing our levels of service. And I certainly don't want to see that. I don't think I've ever, ever had a citizen come to me and say, by the way, can you cut back a little bit on what you do? No. In fact,
and
the demands go higher,
taxes are
and
too
higher
high.
And higher. And we were talking about utilities here, first of all, which are only applicable to certain portions of the township, right? Water and sewer is not everywhere. But those that do pay those utilities require a service. You are taking away their sewage and you're providing them with fresh water. So these are not things to be trifled with. At minimum, you have to maintain existing levels of service to provide those services in a safe and efficient manner and to what our citizens expect. So anyway, Madam Chair, I just would like you to maybe be a little bit more fair, because we can't have one councillor talking all the time about reducing the existing levels of services when that is not actually a decision that council's made.
All right, thank you. Councillor Davis?
Can you hear me? Oh, I'm sorry. Okay. Everybody here has a button, so this is very important. So everyone has the ability to push their button. Commitment to maintaining established service levels. You said that was something you just put in this year?
No, it's something that actually doesn't go. It's sort of a, we operate under it. Staff operate under that. There's been no change. Council's not ordered any change in service levels. And as Mr. Backen has said, the service levels have been in place for years, and we've been operating to maintain those service levels for years. So when staff starts to be able to starts to struggle to be able to maintain the service levels, that's when these cost increases come to light.
Right. Okay. But I'm sorry. I thought you said that that's something you maybe brought from Abbotsford and Surrey or something.
No. I'm presenting it this way for the first time this year.
Oh, okay.
Yes.
Okay. Yeah. Because we have years and years of experience in maintenance service levels. That's very specific, isn't it? That's water, sewer, that's snow, you know, that.
Sometimes it is. It's that a park needs to be cut twice a week or once a week or three times a week. It's, you know, if you cut it once a week, you hear from the user groups. If you cut it three times a week, you might hear from the user groups that you don't need to cut it three times a week. If you do it twice, you don't hear from anybody. You go,
So this is something that you've compounded and compounded over years.
Yeah, over the years, staff have received the feedback and adjusted and to maintain what is the optimum service level.
You also threw in there, though, if you make a new park, then you've got to immediately maintain it with fertilizer and water.
Yeah.
So it's not. So it could be a little more complicated than maybe what I'm thinking it is. It's not simple.
Some there are reviews of service level reviews to determine whether you want to keep going in the different areas with the service levels that have been established over the years.
Okay, I'm just trying to get a grasp on it. Sure. Thank you very much.
Councillor Arneson.
Yes, thank you. I have a couple of questions. I hope mine is not too hypothetical, but I'm just wondering if you could comment, Ms. Sinclair, on the degree to which these numbers include the potential for a substantial increase of users in 2020. So if I look at a service level, very simplistically, I'm going to say for service calls per 1,000 individuals, you know, we can kind of maybe average or figure that out. But I'm just wondering how to look at that from a perspective of if we would want to consider reducing service levels, the degree to which we're going to increase the risk with an escalating population is
as we've come to this point where we're feeling the need to highlight for council these program increases, it as Mr. Backen has said, this might be an indication of a good time to take a look at things like service levels, and the same thing is true in the capital area, things like the service levels of the capital levels that we want to provide to the community, and certainly that is a review that can be done to quantify it. And I think if I'm hearing you correctly, you're suggesting that maybe we could come up with something that says for this amount of growth, we need, like, for every 10,000 population, I think we do have this in the area of parks actually, every 10,000 population, we add a new community park, something right along those lines, or a new library, or a new, there are those kinds of service levels as well.
Yeah, I guess my comment about this is in the enthusiasm to reduce costs, I wouldn't want to look at the reduction of a service level if it was, from a cost-benefit analysis, not really going to address the problem, because in fact it could increase our costs overall should we fail to maintain or address certain issues that are pretty structurally integral to our whole systems working. So, you know, that's just kind of a comment about that, because I don't see a cost-benefit analysis or, you know, what that looks like in terms of a snapshot of this. But my other thought then is then if you wanted to consider reducing some of these numbers, would it be fair to say that there could be some kind of category created, like a contingency or a reserve fund of some type, if casual labor is needed from time to time, and if like a work order came up, that you could address it that way, rather than just globally suggesting or projecting that those are the required numbers?
It's possible. I think you're talking about a call center type of a format, potentially?
Yeah, I'm not sure if we've ever done anything like that, but it seems to me that if you are not certain about a number, but you're trying to keep it down, that maybe there is some rationality in considering that you're going to, you know, based on staff information, deliver as like the car industry, only when you need it, as opposed to counting for it all and potentially not needing it and then reallocating those monies somewhere else.
I certainly don't want to give the impression that I'm an expert on engineering service levels, because that wouldn't be fair.
But Karen, I think she's suggesting a contingency fund approach to it. So that is that we think we need 8 staff. If we need 9, we go over, and maybe we hire them. And we do have those contingency funds built in. I think the challenge is, and this is a really good question, again, particularly for the stuff that's going to come later, is if we're at the stage where we our volume indicates we need 10 staff and we're operating from 8. How do we make that reconcile with itself? Because if we need to go to 11, we have that contingency. But when we're actually trying to do base numbers to get proper accounting, that's where we have the challenges. And in this area with sewer and water, it's more easily, I think, ascertained and justified. As Mr. Seffi said, we can do that because it relates to technical requirements and hours and volumes and those things. But as we get to the next section on general things, for example, it becomes much more ambiguous. It relates more to the level of service as opposed to a requirement. And those, it may be easier to adjust by suggesting we're going to examine the service level rather than simply try to cover the gap by off the corner of one's desk doing these things from a contingency or from some other source.
Councillor Ferguson.
Oh, yeah. Dialogue already on some of these things. We're talking about the program increases and maintaining existing service. We haven't even gone, if I may, to councillors rather than staff. We haven't even got to the line entries that come up, that some are high, medium, and low. And I'm talking about ditch clearing, dike work, patching of roads, facility repair, paint, etc. So as much as we're talking about the general, which a point, you know, we're not looking at a 10% increase, and far from it, we have to kind of be prudent with what we do with the tax increase. I still think it's important to note that we haven't looked at the line entries. I think those line entries will determine an existing service or not an existing service. And I think that's done by managers every year, isn't it, if I may?
The managers start looking at their base budget on a line entry, line by line basis, for sure.
So how does this get in the way with base budget as to what gets approved and what that does not get approved by a council?
So what this is inferring is, because I believe staff would say that these are non-discretionary, it's a constant struggle. It is what this is representing, is a struggle to keep the service levels at the existing service levels, and it's getting to the point where it's almost not feasible. So they're asking for this additional funds in order to maintain that without having to constantly take from here to do it over here and move the money around, and then something, it's like plates, the great analogy of plates spinning. Stop this, get that one going, and then move over here, and then this one's, is that exactly? They're just right now, it's a struggle to get it done.
Okay, let me use an example. I think that everybody in this room can understand. If it snows, we're going to have a need to clear that snow with all the other staff and everything. If it doesn't snow, then we're better off. So I mean, that's another example.
That's a great example. And to the degree that we have surpluses each year, which will not be forever, and especially as we're tightening up the budget, that'll not be forever. But when snow clears, it's all hands on deck, regardless of what any, you know, we have to get that service level met. And then what happens is, if they overspend in the area of snow clearing, we have been fortunate enough in the last several years to have a bit of surplus that they can rely on.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, Councillor Richter.
Thank you. Going back to the comments made by Councillor Long, I would like to draw Council's attention to the last page of Ms. Sinclair's memo to Council that was sent out last week, and the top two paragraphs. And paragraph 2 says, the items in the list above are requested by staff to maintain existing service levels. Costs incurred to maintain existing service levels are typically referred to as non-discretionary. However, due to the magnitude of the amount requested for 2020, these items are highlighted for council discussion and consideration. Now, I don't think I'm misinterpreting the idea there that we are supposed to be discussing these, that this maintaining existing service levels is part of what's driving us into very complicated budgets and very expensive budgets, and staff are looking for direction to us. So I think if Councillor Long took a look at those two paragraphs, he might have a better understanding of why I'm raising the points that I'm raising, which is to question the existing service levels. Thank you.
Moving right along.
And these are the positions that are being requested in the area of water, sewer, and solid waste. Most of these positions are shared, cost shared across water, sewer, sometimes solid waste, and also transportation and storm and sometimes parks. So I did have a note in my memo as well to the degree that they could be accommodated in the user-free budgets, but they might not be able to be accommodated on the universal side. This would be in the category of auxiliary wages as well, that staff can start using the support if they're approved here on the user-free side until such time as we can catch up on the universal services side. So these are positions, these are cost-shared portions of positions that are being requested.
One question from Councillor Whitmarsh.
Thank you. So earlier we talked about non-discretionary and many of those items being done sort of on the sides of desks, and that's not a great plan moving forward. So are these discretionary items, are these items that are currently not being done that we would like to do, or are these also items that are done on the side of the desk and we're just happy to continue doing them on the side of the desk?
So that's a really great question. So usually when it comes to positions, we call them discretionary. But I think that most staff who've put forward these positions would suggest, with maybe the exception of a corporate energy specialist where you have a project that you get them to do because it's money that special money, but in the area of the drafting technician, the clerk three, support clerk, and financial analyst, they would argue that they're required to maintain existing service levels. But because we're asking you for something very serious, which is a position, we're calling it discretionary. And that's been the practice of the township, is to call them discretionary when it's positions.
Right, okay. So these items that are listed here are items that are probably being done right now.
Correct.
Just maybe on the side of someone's desk. And there is a better way to do it. That's the suggestion here. But they would require new people.
Correct.
To add to that.
Yeah.
Okay, thank you.
Councillor Long.
Yeah, thanks. Just to clarify here on this memo that has been referred to, are we sure that's correct? If it says item one is commitment to maintaining existing service levels. And then it talks about item two and three, commitment to infrastructure, which is something new that, well, not new now, but it's something that came up in the last two or three terms, was to put money aside to build our infrastructure. So there's money's put aside there. And this asset maintenance was also a concept that's come up in the last two or three terms. So are you sure that, that it says in that paragraph that's been referred to items one, two, and three? So maybe it's items two and three that are discretionary. Is item one really something that staff want us to decide upon? And if so, maybe we should make a motion.
So item one, you're quite correct. Item one in past years would have been included. The 4.12 would have been 6.83. Or whatever, 2.72 more of it. So that in past years, this would have been included as non-discretionary. But just due to the fact of the magnitude of it, when we get to the universal services side, we've isolated for council to talk about, much in the same way as I just talked about with positions. They're a significant item. This is a significant amount. So we've tried to bring them together to make some sense of it for why the budget is going up as much as it's going up this year.
But item two and three are... That's just money that we put into, but that's money that we do to bolster our infrastructure and to make sure our assets are protected.
Items 2 through 5 have typically been dealt with as discretionary in past years. You're correct. The comment about items 1, 2, and 3 is, again, hearkening back to that staff would probably argue that these are required to maintain existing service levels, but due to the magnitude of them, they're separated out.
I see them as quite different. I see one as being a non-discretionary, although we keep talking about it here, and two and three is as things that we can be discussed.
So perhaps as a decision-making criteria, and there's always exceptions to it, so I hesitate to say it, generally speaking, the non-discretionary are considered to be needed to meet the service levels, but those are usually going to have some external basis. Not always, but generally some external basis, such as health and safety needs or those sorts of things. So an example would be if we have a machine that's cutting the ditches, for example, if we're doing 1,000 kilometers of road per year, each year we're adding more roads, so then you'll see the non-discretionary is to simply keep cutting those roads, say, to 1,200 kilometers per year. That's going to be considered non-discretionary. But for our own purposes, then, once we actually flow over to where we say, well, we need to have additional staff to cut those roads, as opposed to simply just continuing to try to piecemeal it, that's when, because it's adding staff, it's considered to be discretionary, generally speaking, because it's actually showing that there's some ability to try to use other mechanisms. If there's a rule that comes into play that then says, oh, we must must actually hire that staff, or we must find a way to deliver that service, but then it can flip it back. And some of the examples you'll see with that might be because of collective agreement requirements when you have so many auxiliaries, because of provincial requirement, I better finish that phrase, because you have so many auxiliaries. There are trips that occur where when you have a certain number of auxiliary hours, you're supposed to convert those to regular or part-time positions. Where you may have provincial regulations that you should be cutting because of concerns about environment or habitat, those become some of the things that can trip us back from being discretionary to non-discretionary. But the general principle is it's simply for the non-discretionary, it's to meet the same level of cutting in my example, it's just that there's an increased number of roads.
Well, just Madam Chair, just to be clear then, I think at some point we're going to have to decide on whether item one is something that we're going to muck with or not. Because if at the end of this we get the message which keeps coming every few minutes that we maybe should be questioning existing levels, then what is staff going to do between now and the next meeting? Go back and do that or not? So would you be looking for a motion, or you'd be looking for?
I think it's a bit premature, and this is the easy section only in terms of this is paid by the user pay utilities. So these utilities are going to be the water, the sewer, those that actually are connected. As we come to the general tax funded ones, it's a bit more of a challenge because there's so many more and there's so many different views on those. I think the purpose of this as we began the session was to again to educate and to pull out some of the things we've traditionally dealt with because the numbers are becoming daunting. And that's why I want to be very, very, very clear. We don't have a recommendation at this point in terms of what the appropriate level is. It's not as simple as us as simply totaling them all up because those totals are one view. There's many views to this opaque, window where we're trying to figure out what we're trying to achieve, and that's going to be based upon health and safety needs, but also this council's desire to set service levels that are appropriate for this term and this community at this time.
I wonder if it would be helpful if we had the comments from past budgets in terms of utilities from the public that we could be referenced at least, because it might give us a starting point as to whether or not there's a desire from those that are paying for these services to see cuts or whatever, or maybe perhaps the opposite. But those comments are around, and we won't get comments for this until council's finished with it. But there are comments existing from past budgets that would be perhaps helpful. Thank you.
And then this just pulls it all together. So it starts with the non-discretionary and what base, maybe it's more efficient to call it base budget changes. The programs being added here, the discretionary items, and this is where we land up with water, sewer, and solid waste. 5.01, mostly because of the GVWD costs, $800,000 in new water purchases and $800,000 preparing for the Jericho Reservoir Phase 2. And then the sewer, 1.5, keeping it at an incremental increase, knowing that in the next 4 years, it's going to be much larger. And then solid waste in year one of the five-year program of 0% increases. So that is...
Karen, perhaps we could simply pause there for a bit, because this is an important slide in that it brings everything together, because I think you did a very good job of itemizing that the cost drivers then really are relatively minor, but for the fact of water. And water, I think you highlighted what's actually driving water. What's driving water is twofold. I think it's a pump station, and it's also going to be the water purchases that were, again, valid policy decisions. One is to quantity, and one is to quality. Quantity being to make sure we have enough supply for existing and future uses, and also the quality in one of the communities where there was concerns about the quality of the water that was coming through because of a manganese issue, and we wanted to make sure we dealt with that. So that meant we were adding supply.
Actually, that one will be on the next slide, the Murrayville water issue. This one is the reservoir, Jericho Phase 2 reservoir, cost of $800,000. Okay. But in addition, on the one-time slide, we do have Murrayville water purchases from Metro Vancouver as a fairly significant one-time acquisition from surplus. And groundwater assessment study. These are the types of things that you'll see in the one-times, the one-time expenditures where we don't like to peak the operating budget 1 year and then bring it back down the next year. So these are all one-time items that will happen for 2020 and then fall away. And they're coming from a one-time source of funding, which is surplus.
I do have a question from Councillor Davis.
Just to clarify,
water purchase from Metro Vancouver. That's not going to be a one-time thing, is it? One time a year? I mean, we're going to continue to, if we're going to solve the problem, we're going to have to mix it. And
we will, but I'll let, anybody else want to speak up to this? Ron, I think.
The analysis will demonstrate to us the need for either continuing with the Metro Vancouver water purchase, additional Metro Vancouver water purchase, or implementing systems or additional steps in the process of quality control that would then address the aesthetic issues. So it may be a one-time, it may not be.
So what Raman is saying, I think, is that for the moment, we're assuming it's a one-time. It may become perpetual, but it's one-time for now until we can complete our analysis and studies. If we can fix the problem and use groundwater, then we would be able to effectively not purchase it. The trick to that, though, is that's a qualitative issue. There's also the quantity issue in terms of what it's doing to the aquifer, and we haven't interpreted that in terms of the direction of council. We've assumed that we were to, again, to try to minimize the costs by way of dealing with the issue as opposed to some other thoughts that maybe that we shouldn't be using groundwater at all.
Okay, thank you.
Councillor Woodward.
Yeah, I wanted to ask about the footnote number 2, whether you have any idea of what the range of savings might be.
Groundwater assessment study?
No, footnote number 2. For Mariva water purchases of $1.4 million, potentially be savings. Do you have any idea what the range of that savings might be yet?
I've just got that there could be cost savings as we may switch over to GVWD water in a phased approach. But to calculate this prior to the budget would be not possible. So we have to do some more work on that. But it's by adopting a phased approach that we could bring that amount down.
Yeah, no, I remember that when we approved this amount, but there's no indication, just want to clarify again, there's no indication or mechanism to potentially identify what that savings might be?
Not that I have with me today.
All right, thanks.
Councillor Richter.
Yeah, $1.425 million for the Murrayvale water purchase. Do we have confirmation from Metro on that? Is that what they're actually going to charge us? Because I raised it at Metro and they kind of looked at me like I was, didn't know what I was talking about. So
this is not an unusual request. It is simply an extrapolation of the costs based on the bulk purchase that we have in terms of the additional needs to meet the requirements of our existing users in Murrayvale. If we were to shut down the existing wells in Murrayvale and continue with the additional purchase. So the staff ordinarily wouldn't know about this because this is just, as I said, an estimate of what it would cost us to purchase additional water from Metro Vancouver.
Okay. Is there any way we could get a firm cost estimate from them before, like instead of just putting a budget number in that we haven't checked with them, I would like to get verification from them.
Because
we have to do something about the water in Murrayvale.
So I think what I'll try to rephrase what Raman said if I've got it correct. I think what we've done is we've taken the amount of water that we've taken out of the system from the wells. We've put that quantity as if it's coming from Metro Vancouver, and then we multiply that by their rate per gallon, if you will, and that leads to that number. I think that's the approach we've taken. So as to the second question is, well, could that number be lower? And the answer is it could be lower. We don't know by how much. To Councillor Woodward's question, it depends upon if we can actually phase it in, still use some of the well water, but not have it become a negative in terms of the users' experiences in Murrayvale itself. So it represents, we hope to be the top end of what it could be, based upon the fact that we switched over 100%. We'd hopefully switch over time, and perhaps at a various level of percentages. But that number that we know we ultimately go to, and multiplied by our cost of water, equals this. So it's
yeah. But could we still get a confirmation from Metro? Because I don't understand why we would put a big number in the budget if we didn't need to put a big number in the budget.
So it's a bit, I'll try it again because I don't think we're explaining it very well. We know, it's like gasoline, I suppose. We know the going wholesale rate for the cost of gasoline, maybe a dollar a liter. We know there's a million liters, so as a consequence, we can put that number in. The number is given to us by Metro Vancouver in terms of what the cost per liter is. What we're saying is the issue is not in the cost per liter, it's in the volume that we may use. They can't really help us with the volume we may use because we know what it's going to take to replace all the the water from the wells that we're discontinuing, but we don't know if we can actually still blend to a certain extent or do some things to bring that cost down. Ram, am I?
That's correct. To put it another way, it's actually an estimate. It's a projection, and it's got two assumptions, I guess, if you want to call them that, built in. One is the volume. It is based on historic uses, what we expect to have to pay for in the future, and then the other one is the actual dollar amount in terms of the cost per cubic meter, and we anticipate that to be whatever the number is or has been without any significant change. So it's a projection of a future cost that cannot be verified by Metro Vancouver necessarily.
Okay, thank you.
Councillor Woodward.
I just want to follow up on some of Mr. Backett's comments in that. So where I was going with the 1.425 million is some portion of that's going to be permanent. If we are switching over to more Metro Vancouver water for Murrayville on an indefinite basis, some portion of that's permanent. Is that fair?
It would be. Yeah. Another way of looking at it is it could be a placeholder until we've determined how much will be permanent, in which case you'll see it coming forward in next year probably.
Right. So one option would be to do some of that now. So one option would be to take the 1.4 million, just simplistically divide it by two, put half of that as a permanent assumption into water, and then leave the other half, which is still to be determined, in prior year surplus.
Could do that.
That would potentially free up some prior year surplus and essentially move over to water what's probably plus or minus a bit going to be permanent anyway in a relatively low year versus what's coming. So I just wanted to confirm that. So my math is that every 230,000 of additional water is approximately 1%. Do I have that right? I want to put you on the spot.
Yes,
math.
Yeah.
That's about right, right?
That's right, yeah.
So if we moved over 750, we would be increasing that by 2.5% further, roughly, plus or minus?
3%.
3%, okay. Yeah. So I'm going to note that, and I just want thanks for confirming that. Thanks.
Councillor Davis.
Maybe, Council. This is for the first year. If we were to cut this in half, would this mean it would be for 6 months? Just a question. Is that what you're thinking?
Or Woodward?
So maybe Ms. Sinclair can help me, but just an idea that depending on the status of prior year surplus overall, which is not shown here, this is only for one times in some of these categories, if we know that some consumption of Murrayville is permanently going to increase water utility, whether it's 750, half of this number, is going to be a permanent additional supply for Metro, we could move that over to water now and then have 750 in water, 750, again, I'm just rounding numbers up, 750 in water utility, 750 from prior year surplus, that would be more indicative of where we're headed, rather than coming back next year, say it's $1 million that we're adding to the water utility. We could do it in stages and also free up prior year surplus for other items this year. Would that be fair? Summary?
Yeah.
That's an option to consider.
That's an option. Yeah.
Thank you.
Did that clarify, Councillor?
No.
No,
I'm not trying to critique you. It's just that if
it's not about 6 months here and 6 months there, it's about a permanent understanding that more water from Murrayville will be coming from Metro Vancouver, not what's indicated here, which is that it's a one-time thing.
Well, we just heard from Mr. Backham that when this assessment study, groundwater assessment study, comes out, I guess we have to think maybe it's not going to come out of the aquifer if we can fix that problem. It's going to come out of GVRD. I guess that's what you're thinking. Yeah. Okay.
I'm actually looking for a way to recover some capacity of prior year surplus for other items when we're recognizing that some portion of that 1.25 is going to be a permanent increase in the water utility. Mr. Backman, do I have that summarized correctly?
I think what you're suggesting, just to paraphrase back, if there was an additional 1% increase in the water utility, that would generate about $230,000 in additional revenue. That revenue then would be used to decrease the water purchases, because that's the threshold that we believe it's going to be. And that would mean that we'd have, again, additional surplus in the water utility that we could then use for other purposes, again, for the as set out in the water utility. So that is sound. That just would then be, again, to anticipate that the ultimate study that we do will suggest that we will have to use some portion of Metro Vancouver water permanently.
Yeah, but this is only freeing it up within the water utility, right? And this is a Correct. Bit of a frustration of mine that continues to accumulate, that we've got these surpluses where we don't want them. Would that be, maybe you don't mind where they are, but I don't see them much useful here versus other categories. We have other priorities. And the only solution to that is internal borrowing, which is something that you have to keep track of, which I can imagine is just more work that eventually has to be put back. Right. Yeah, thanks.
Councillor Long.
Yeah, that's the way it is. It's a utility that funds itself, so that's where the money is coming, goes in and comes out and so forth. But, I mean, I understood, and we spent a lot of time at the council meeting trying to figure out how you guys are going to fix the problem with Murrayville, and my understanding was that there was going to be this assessment done, and that it is possible that we could get back to using all the wells if they had treatments centers put into them or equipment put into it. So, I mean, we don't know what that number is, right? And are there actually, as is being suggested, other priorities that the surplus is going to be dedicated to? Probably not. So, and if it's not used this year, it goes back into the surplus, right? But I mean, is this notion that I'm hearing that there's going to be a permanent demand on Metro Vancouver water, has that been established? Or it really isn't, because we haven't got the assessment done?
I think that the presenting this as a one-time is recognizing that there's still more work to be done in reviewing the entire situation, and it's rather than add it into the ongoing, what would be the ongoing user fee increase, it's buying us the year to do the analysis is the way I'm looking at it.
And it might end up that with treatment, you know, like we did in Aldergrove, treatment facilities at each of the wells might solve it. Is that not where we left it?
That I'd have to defer to engineering for.
Can I get that answer from Mr. Safey?
That is correct. The assessment has not been completed yet in terms of what the ultimate costs might be, but I think Councillor Woodward said it best in that a portion of what you see is likely going to be our cost. It's just unknown at this point as to what that portion is. What we have done in the meantime at this point, we can, I guess, confirm that there is no groundwater that has been causing the aesthetic issues in Murrayville. So all the wells have been turned off that have been causing that issue, and we're currently purchasing Metro Vancouver water to compensate for what used to be coming out of the ground.
Councillor Woodward.
Yeah, no, I think I appreciate that clarification from Mr. Seffi. Councillor Long must have missed the fact that that was, in fact, my first question, that there is a portion of that 1425 which will become permanent. Yes. So, again.
Likely.
You know that for sure?
Yeah, I kind of do, actually, because I went on a tour and talked to the staff about it. So maybe you should go do that, Councillor Long. So I'm trying to be helpful in the sense that, which we don't have in front of us yet, is a list of capital projects from the utility that maybe we're not funding because we're funding this water out of prior year surplus. So again, that was the direction I was going, and I'm only trying to be helpful. And I understand for councillors that have been here for a couple of decades that perhaps some of these questions are irritating, but I think it would be helpful to note that for council for when we get that list of capital projects. Thank you.
Looks like we have another question from or comment from Councillor Ferguson.
Okay, so it's good that we're talking about this now because I didn't really want to ask how many wells were in the system, how many pumps are in the system, how many water lines, and how many liters or something we pump per year. But I did want to ask a question. I didn't know we were going to shut down every single well in the Murrayville area. I thought we were going to target just certain ones and work accordingly, if I may, through the chair.
That's what's been done. I apologize if I...
I thought you heard me said everything was turned off.
Everything that's been contributing towards the aesthetics issues in Murrayville has been turned off on a temporary basis until we figure out exactly what the solution might be long term. This is a short term measure.
We're off budget, but I don't mind being off budget. Do you know, have you got an idea when we're going to have some answers?
In the next 3-4 months.
Okay, so that's how long it takes to get this kind of an answer?
That's correct.
And from a scientific point of view, and again, I'm not a scientist, the water really was not affecting the public health standards guidelines. That's correct?
Well, I have to be careful about that because the standards did change. I believe late last year they may have changed the Canadian guidelines for aesthetics in water changed, in that historically it was not considered to be a health issue, or at least a standard issue. It has never been a health issue. It's no longer, it continues not to be a health issue, but it's still, it has recently been determined to be an aesthetic issue in terms of not meeting the guidelines. Therefore, we must deal with it one way or the other, and we're aiming to do that.
Okay, thank you. There's a whole bunch of other questions I would have, but I'm not a scientist, nor... some of us have been on wells before, some of us have, and we have filters on our wells. There's all sorts of things I could say from a kind of a management point of view, and I have to talk to everybody who's ever owned a well. I know Councillor Davis has probably owned wells for years, and there's all sorts of things you can do to make changes to the delivery at the end, and I'm not sure where we're at with that. Thank you.
No other questions from councillors.
Okay. Then that brings us to what could be a resolution, and it's the first one for now, that council receive and refer the 2020 utility user pay operating budget to a future special meeting for council for purposes of further consideration, discussion, and approval as received or amended. Ultimately, down the line, we'll be looking for that second amendment, but right now we're just moving to the next.
Madam Chair, just a brief explanation. The second one's what we usually see. As we alluded to at the beginning, this is not a typical year for us because of the collision of some of the challenges we're facing. So we've reverted to the first one as being the suggested recommendation to say we'll discuss this further. But if there's any direction that some feel adamant about, we can take them now, or we can just let it float. We've got some feedback now from Council. We can try to do so. So it's really what Council wants to do at this point. So we're not looking for a concrete decision at this point, but it's a chance to provide some direction.
Okay, I do have a comment from Councillor Richter.
Yeah, I think that there have been some good questions that have been raised that we need to get some answers on, so I'm willing to move the first resolution there.
All right, do I have a seconder? Councillor Davis? Any discussion? Okay, I'm going to clear the queue, or shall I start with Councillor Davis?
Sure.
Okay,
because
you were up first.
Sorry. Okay, I'm going to speak to this. I definitely think there's some, I'm not finished, I don't think, with Councillor Woodward's comments. I think Councillor Rickover brought up with a number of comments. So I don't think we should put this to public right now. There's more questions than answers. That's why I think I would support this to another meeting. Okay, thanks.
Thank you. Councillor Whitmarsh.
Just confirming, when we talk here, a future budget meeting, are we talking about January 27th, the 10:30 time slot that we have set?
So January 27th is when we plan to bring forward the capital, and we could have some discussion if time allows then, but we also have provided February 3rd as well.
Okay, so it's be either of those two dates. Okay, thank you.
Councillor Ferguson, I have you on the queue.
Yeah, good. Okay, so I also wanted to ask if there's been, this is a resolution I wish I'll be supporting, of course, that we receive and refer. There was also some questions that were asked during this time frame that I used to call flag. I don't know if you call them flag anymore. That, you know, need some either extra explanation, and that the well explanation, the one-time explanation, the Murrayville water, and some of the other questions that were asked, whether they'll be coming, you'll be coming to council at the next meeting on the 27th with some either answers or supplemental comments.
Yes, we'll do our best to keep the process going by trying to bring those answers back on the 27th.
And I guess we can send you emails or questions or stuff like that to help you out with that as well.
Okay. Always.
Okay, I don't see any other questions, so maybe we'll call the question. All in favor? I'll do a show of hands because I don't have an item number for that. And it passes unanimously.
Now, Madam Chair, if there was to be a break, now would be the opportune time to do it, a 5-minute break if you wished, or we can proceed. It's your call.
All right. Do I need a motion? Okay, 5 minutes. Quick go, Bob. Good afternoon. I suppose we could reconvene. I think we're just missing one councillor, and there's a big party up there going on, but... We can get started.
All right. So I just jump in?
Sure.
Okay. The Universal Services, Mark and I are going to, he's got some comments throughout as we go, as do I. So we're going to play a bit of tag team. I will move through the first couple slides because they're redundant. You've seen this one already on the timeline. And the first new slide is items referred to the budget process.
Okay, so excuse me. Yeah. Before we get started, we do have one question from Councillor Woodward.
It's on the budget timeline. So if you could go back one slide, please. So I thought we might come back to this in the last version, but I just want to ask quickly about this timeline. It's a little more compressed than last year. So I'm looking at it here, January 27th, to get both budgets presented, and then to have the last meeting between going to budget Q&A straight to open houses is 7 days. Is there some way to get some more time in there than 7 days between having the budgets and essentially going to open houses as far as council's concerned?
So I think the short answer is likely there is. There are some detailed, I guess, timelines to watch, but these kind of represent weeks to us in terms of the weeks that we're trying to identify and from now until the end. There may be some notification requirements, but there should be some time to spend additional time if council so desires and be able to digest it a bit further.
Last year we had, even though it might look more compressed at the front end, last year where it was compressed was at the back end, and it was quite a feat to get the final budget adopted and get the tax rates approved and in time to send them to the printer and have them printed for the tax notices.
It's a little more compressed at the front end because we won't actually have the budget until the end of the day on the 27th. And the issue with the 27th, of course, is that on Thursday afternoon and Friday morning, I'm going to have the budget plus the agenda package, some items in Alder Grove, and some other important items to work on over the weekend. That only leaves us, again, 7 days to really sit with the entire budget.
Right. We might be able to add a day that's a non-council.
So I'll just leave it out there for council's consideration. It's going to be a little bit difficult, potentially, to do it, maybe do what we did last year, which is exchange some ideas over email and bat some stuff around. If we only have, I guess, 4 business days to do that, that's going to make that process almost impossible. Thanks.
Councillor Richter.
Yeah, I don't understand why we're having the public open houses the 10th and 11th. Why not the following week, that third week in February, on the 18th and the 19th?
That's possible. It's just it wouldn't be a council night, and it wasn't last year either, so that's still doable. And then it would be a very quick turnaround on the 24th. But we have to squeeze all of these dates, so we'll have to look at sort of like a mobile. You move one of them and the other ones move, but we'll definitely look and see if we can
Well, you get public input online, right?
Yeah.
You could open the online input on the 10th, but not have the open houses until the following week. And then if council needs to have another budget meeting, they can get it in on that week of the 10th.
Yeah. So there was two items in the on the operating side referred to the budget process. Those items, the items tend to be more capital in nature, but these are two operating items. One is the alternative property tax penalty system. So that's moving from one due date where a 10% penalty is charged on late taxes or taxes unpaid versus 2 5% penalties having the two due dates. So typically what happens is if a person has the first 5% penalty, they have that heads up and they come in and they, if it was just a case of them not remembering, they come in and they get their taxes paid. So we probably will lose some tax revenue, some penalty revenue from that, not tax revenue, penalty revenue from that, which is one of the reasons why we're doing it for the taxpayers, is so that they don't get hit with the 10% penalties. But there is a one-time adjustment required to calibrate the system to the penalty revenue that we're likely to see on a two-date system, which is in the lower mainland, it's every other municipality except us.
Okay. Councillor Richter?
Yeah. So I just want to make sure that these $300,000, does that mean that we bring in $600,000 in late penalties every year?
No. We bring in about $1.2 million. But this is just using other municipalities and how much of a percentage their second date penalties are as their first. It's trying to interpolate what that might be for us.
Okay.
Yeah. So it's $1.2 million is our total penalty revenue.
Okay. Councillor Long.
Okay. Well, and we've done. I don't know how you would do this analysis, but I mean, are we sure that maybe some people might take advantage of this, and those that have always paid on time might choose not to get a little stretch there if they're in a tough spot.
That's definitely possible. I do believe that would be on the small side compared to this group.
All right, I guess we'll have to see.
Yeah.
We'll have to see.
Councillor Davis.
Very quickly, just to clarify that, it's roughly every year, it's $1.5 million we bring in on penalty?
1.2, yeah.
So this is for the people. This isn't for the income.
This is for the people, correct? It was people.
Yeah, I remember when it was brought in. But I had no idea that we could use $1.2 million. Okay.
Councillor Woodward.
I'm being cheeky. Thanks.
Yeah, my question is related to the climate items. Maybe we'll let you explain it first.
Sure. This is just with the climate emergency that the township signed on to, state emergency. This is just to launch the program for the operating side. We're going to be identifying projects on the capital side as being climate in support of climate change or not. But this is an amount required on the operating side. That staff have asked for to meet that goal.
Okay, and so can I just get a break? I'm just flag it, or that's still the terminology we're using. I'd like to get a break out of that to myself and the rest of council. I think that was what if you go back and watch the video, that was my concern. It's all well and good to adopt, emissions targets and reductions to the benefit of maybe the Green Party's global national plan to get us all to do that. And then here we are. At the time, I said I didn't know what costs I was incurring or voting to support, and now here we are with costs that weren't even itemized for us when we were debating that, which I think was part of their strategy, which is fine. Adopt targets, get everybody committed, and then hit them with the cost later. But I'd like to know what that is specifically, if that's possible. Thanks.
Councillor Arneson.
Yes. Thank you. Further to that, when I was reading the notes and I saw a price now attached to this, what I thought would be helpful is that if staff have pre-identified, if possible, any offsets that could be accomplished through this. One thing I do know is that there's a figure that's here, but there's a lot of government funding that's available through the federal and provincial government for climate action. And so there could be some measures, but only if we have somebody who's working in a detailed manner to look at what those grants or funding could be. So if there was even a ballpark figure, for example, it might be fully 50% of it, of that cost, could be recoverable that way.
That's correct. And you bring up a good point. In reading the detail of this from the report, it is to apply for grant programs, provincial and federal. So there could very well be grant revenue, but from a conservative perspective, we've just included this in. We haven't included an estimate of what the grants might be.
So. Okay, well, it's clear that it may be helpful for council to consider that, because I do understand, especially if there's expenditure and in times when it's more challenging to come up with our budgetary means, that we could look at something. What I don't want to do is give short shrift to this without full consideration of what the actual cost is once you take out that component of what, in all likelihood, as other communities have done, we would be eligible for. I know there's no rubber stamp to say for sure that we could get that, but on the other hand, I know that those levels of government are very much committed, as is Metro, to make sure that we're working towards our targets.
I've made a note of it.
Thank you.
Councillor Ferguson.
Well, I'm fine, thanks.
Okay. Councillor Long.
Thank you. $1 million, so we've been collecting that from poor folks. Where does it show up in the? I guess we don't have it as a big budget line.
Penalty revenue, penalty and interest revenue.
And we're allowed to spend all of that? The province doesn't.
Yeah, it just comes in as general revenue.
Okay. Yeah. Okay. Yeah. All right. Thanks.
And then we have a similar chart to what you saw on the user pay utility side, only the revenues are slightly different. Instead of user pay, user fee revenue, it's just general tax revenue from growth and other user fees and charges, which typically is recreation services, rentals and leases, permits and licenses. So we have some fairly large, robust other user fee categories on the universal side. And the expenditures are very similar, other than salary and wages as the largest item on the expenditure side for universal services. Special contracts are RCMP, Fraser Valley Regional Library, even though it's separate, it's levied separately, we have it here. Ecom and recycling, regional district and TransLink for storm transportation and stormwater works, maintenance contracts, mowing, information technology, materials and supplies, equipment and vehicle costs ongoing, asset management, and again, the new category at the bottom, programs. And this is just a graphical picture of those numbers. Revenues and expenses. And the issues and challenges on the universal side, which when I say universal services, that's the property tax supported side, is that we'll have a slide for each of these bullets. Regional costs, RCMP, commitment to protective services, and the Fraser Valley Regional Library. Salary and wage contract settlements, AFF has expired, and QP will be expiring at the end of 2020. Operating impact of township capital and community development, which we talked about on the user side. This is the same, but on the universal services tax-supported side. Commitment to infrastructure and asset management, which again is continuing to contribute to the capital program from the operations, continuing, where applicable, to have transfers to capital reserves, and contribution to paving, diligence in providing funding levels that support asset maintenance now and into the future. And then the final bullet is again the commitment to maintain existing service levels, program and contract increases. I'll have a slide on each of these.
Okay, just have a question from Councillor Richter.
So are we in negotiations already with the IAFF?
I don't believe so. No, not yet.
Not yet. Okay. When will we be going into negotiations? Oh, so we'll end up with whatever the big guys want, right? Okay, got you. Same question here about commitment to maintain established service levels. That's open to discussion this time.
Correct.
Around. Okay, thank you.
Councillor Whitmarsh.
Thanks. With the IAFF as well as QPD, with the negotiations there, the time frame is going to be into 2020. Does it then have an impact on the 2020 budget? Because we're without contract then now, so we're living with the existing contract, I guess.
Correct.
And so whenever this gets negotiated, does that then come back sort of retroactively?
We provide a provision in fiscal services for contracts that have expired. So we are including something in this budget for contracts that have expired.
So we're sort of making some kind of assumption of what might happen.
Correct.
Okay. And so then with the QP for 2020, the implications for that is actually starting in 2021.
Correct.
Is that right? Okay. Thank you.
Okay. RCMP. So this is that part of RCMP that is just a rollover of the contract from one year to the next. So this doesn't include new officers. It doesn't include annualizations of the officers added last year. Removing the annualization. This is just the rollover of the RCMP contract of 563.35. The largest components of the RCMP contract are salaries and indirect costs, and I'll be showing you a breakdown of those in a second. The salaries... Their members have been without a contract since January 1st, 2017. So they are also negotiating potential increases from 2017 to now. And we've included amount in there compounded over that period of time. But for 2020, we've got this amount in here, $217,000. Indirect costs, and there's no indication as to what that increase might look like. So it's still highly being negotiated. Indirect costs, with the exception of member pension, all indirect costs are charged on an FTE basis, and I'll be showing you that FTE basis in a second, but the cost rolling over is $70,322. These are components of the 560 in the first paragraph. And then finally, at the end, divisional administration, the largest component of indirect, is coming at an additional $272,833. So the rollover of the contract for RCMP is $560,335.
I do have a question from Councillor Ferguson.
Okay.
Yeah. Now, is the indirect cost divisional, page 9, administration, that's $28,400 per member?
Correct.
Okay, so they have their salary plus this per member for administration. Has it always been that, or what is it? Has it varied over the years? Or
no, it's been pretty consistent. They have what they call a fully loaded officer member. And this next slide sort of shows the breakdown of what's included in a fully loaded officer.
Oh, okay.
So it's 175,488 is the total, which includes a lot of items. If we were going to do this, we would be adding on things like cell phones and computers and guns if we needed guns. We don't need guns. And uniforms and things like that. So that's what they do. They add it all in.
Okay, I've always wondered about that. Yeah. And I've always wondered over the years, so that gives me an idea since 2016, mm-hmm. which is not that long ago. I'd be interested further back, but I don't need that. Thank you.
And then this is just a comparison of our authorized strength versus average actual strength. So at the end of 2019, with the two officers that were added last year, starting October 1st, we were at 144.65, with the city being at 51.35. This usually comes up, the comparison between the two of us. And you'll notice the city hasn't changed over the years, and I don't believe there is an intention to change this year either. Of that 144.65 authorized strength, we're at an average actual strength of 134.26.
Councillor Richter?
But we're 10 short of what we're authorized for. So when the superintendent came and spoke to us and indicated that he felt there was a need for an additional 15 members, if we filled these 10 spots, would we still need 15 members?
His calculation is based on the authorized strength, so he would say yes. It's unfortunately, there is a long lag time between ordering the new officers and getting them. So what we've included in the budget from 2020 to 2024 is 14 officers over that five-year period. You'll be seeing that shortly. But he would say that you have to get those requests in the pipe. At some point in time, Depot will catch up. And they have been closing the gap a little bit over the last few years. So he would say that we still require the 15 in addition to the 144.
Okay. And with the changeover on the Surrey side to their own police force, would there be RCMP members we could pick up from Surrey?
That has been discussed, yes.
Okay. Yeah. And my last question is, of the members authorized in the township, how many of those actually show up to city events or city calls?
I would have to find that out for you. So the question is, how many township officers respond to city
Yeah, if a call goes out, I don't know, 10 o'clock on a Friday night, do any township cars go to that call if it's in Langley City, as an example?
I'll see what I can find out. Okay.
Councillor Ferguson?
Thank you. I'm looking at the 2016 to 2019 increase officer authorized strength, the city remaining constant. One of my question is the role, it just seems, I mean, I don't expect you to have the answer to this, almost like an information. The role, because I spend so much time in the city, I'm almost apologizing for that. I'm the chairman of the Langley Senior Center. I'm involved with Langley Rotary, which is hit to the city. I do work with some of the churches in the area and helping the homeless. I see the RCMP role of an RCMP officer in the city significantly different than the role of Langley Detachment in the township. Now, we do have, obviously, homeless, but they are down cleaning underneath bridges. They're moving people around, and every time there's a need to break down a camp or move homeless people, I think they got the 9 o'clock roll in the city. I'm not sure what we have in the township. There's an RCMP. Now, 10 years ago, that wasn't the role of the RCMP member in the city. And it seems like even though they're not asking for too many more, their need is different than our need. You know, and I'm not sure how they address that, but that's, you'd need an answer to that. And I don't know who could give an answer. I mean, you can't click your finger and just say, let's fix homeless. Well, let's fix other things. You know, I'm just saying the role of that member is significantly different. And I don't know the crime things, but I see it. We've had a senior center broken into countless times. We have our own security now, and it seems to be the new thing is that people are, the banks and everything, they're all going more and more to their own because it's rampant, and I'm not blaming it all on the homeless, but it seems that the role of that officer is different than the township. That's all. Thank you.
We have Councillor Richter.
Just to pick up on Councillor Ferguson's comments, I'm wondering if we could also get an estimate of increased pressure on calls relative to the Quality Inn opening.
Okay. Councillor Whitmarsh.
Sorry,
no problem. One sec.
Just a quick question. Just so I understand, when it says authorized strength versus average actual, is authorized the based on a formula and sort of recommended to what we should be looking at? Is that what that means?
Authorized is what we actually have approved.
Oh, it's what we've already approved.
Yeah.
Whereas the actual is what we're actually doing.
Right. Correct.
Okay. So does that mean that the like in here for 2019 is a gap of 10? So those have been approved. So just it could be a variety of circumstances of why they've left. It's taking a year or two to fill. Whatever. We're just 10 short.
Correct. Yeah.
But they've been
vacancies
approved already.
Yes.
Okay. Thank you.
And this is the Fraser Valley Regional Library. Even though they are a levy unto themselves, they give us this assessment every year, and so you can see the total is $4.5 million for the library. And that includes some direct costs that they charge us for our individual libraries, staffing, as well as some indirect costs that is sort of like our administrative overhead. They have a charge that they charge all the municipalities that participate in the library program. And then this assessment is collected on the tax notice.
And this is actually a bit of an important slide because as we go forward and consider new library facilities, it's likely we could use this as an opportunity to better reflect our actual costing by, say, not only having the Fraser Valley Regional Library costs associated with our our entry on the tax bill, but also our costs that may be for such things as the operating lease or for the leasehold improvements that we could then do going forward, and perhaps even and retrospectively looking back to take some of our operating costs that we now incur and actually put them into this category in terms of a new category called Fraser Valley Regional Library and Associated Library Costs. We've always wrestled with our contribution for libraries as always being somewhat buried or embedded in our general tax levy. This entry that we now have allows us a bit more flexibility going forward. And unless council has any comments, we would anticipate going down that path in future, because we really think it gives a better transparent level of the actual costs of the system, which I think is very widely respected and very well used and very well appreciated. And I think it would actually make it easier to defend some of the charges we're incurring.
Councillor Richter.
Yeah, I agree with having a separate category on the tax bill for them. I did have a question. I recall several years back, when we didn't have as many libraries as we do have now, that there was a lot of usage of the Langley City Library by Langley Township residents, and that we got assessed a fee for that. Like an additional fee, because our residents were using the Langley City Library instead of our own libraries. Is that still an issue for us?
I actually am not sure, to be honest. I'd have to find out if there is still a fee or if it was a transitional item.
Yeah.
I don't know the answer to
if
that.
If there is still a fee, I'm wondering if we can do something about publicizing. If you live in Langley City, use the Langley City, or if you live in Langley Township, use the Township libraries.
Yeah, I think it's worthwhile checking to see what the number is. Historically, what transpired was that we didn't have very many libraries, so the city library was a bigger facility and was getting a lot more usage, and they were effectively calculating their levy based on the residency of the person that was using the library itself. So in that case, because the library in the city was much larger, they were getting a bigger contribution, and our proportionate share was higher. Since that time, with the opening of our number of our satellite libraries, that usage rate, as I recall, has gone down. And in fact, I think the city's actually downsized that library space because it wasn't being all that well utilized. They weren't getting the compensation. But we can determine what the intergovernmental transfers now are, because it's still based in the system, based on the residency of the user.
Councillor Ferguson.
Yeah, okay. And pardon me for asking for my ignorance. Is Abbotsford and Chilliwack, they're no longer part of the Fraser Valley Regional Library System?
They are, but the sheet was just too long, and they're on page two, mm-hmm. and I didn't include it.
It's a reason, because Abbotsford's quite large.
We're very close to Abbotsford in the assessment, in respect of the assessment.
Okay, sorry for that kind of question. And the next thing is, Councillor Richter's right, there was that, and I'm not sure if it still goes the extra levy. The city of Langley is a regional library. I don't think the township has any regional libraries that I'm aware of. The city of Langley is a regional library.
I think they're all part of the Fraser Valley Regional.
No, but there's one. There's a specific higher level library.
Oh, okay.
It's called, I think it's a name for it. But I thought it was called the region. We're all part of the Fraser Valley Regional Library System, but there's higher level libraries. And
sure.
Yeah, well, I used to be that way. Maybe the rep can help me. And the next thing is, library services. Now they pay all the staff, or we pay the staff?
If the staff are working directly in our libraries, they pay them, but they charge us what they call direct fees. So it is very much like as if they were in our own budget. They charge us directly, and then all of the other costs go into a pool, they're charged out by various cost item depending on what they are. So if it's IT, for example, they're charged based on the number of computers in the city, the township of Langley, versus the whole regional library system. It's proportional. Some items are charged based on the population, because there's no better metric to use. But if they have a metric to use, like computers, they'll use computers. So FVRL charges us. The things that we pay for here are things like janitorial lease costs in the cases where we lease a library, and other just taking care of the facility type costs. But they pay for all staff and all other costs, and then they charge us and in two categories, direct and indirect.
And you've never heard of the different types of libraries? Mr. Tillamero, I say
there aren't.
That's been changed?
They are all part of the Fraser Valley Regional Library System. And to speak with respect to the city of Langley, we may have been contributing to that. That is no longer the case. It has not been the case for over 7 years.
Okay.
These fees are based on library usage,
yeah,
and population. So our libraries are highly used in terms of book lending and other programs that our residents take advantage of at those libraries. So that's what those fees are based on, is that calculation of population as well as usage of library services.
Okay, that's what I thought. Thank you.
And similar to the user pay utility slide, this is a slide for salary and wages in the universal services side, so, property tax supported. You can see the similarity. We again have the 261 to 262 days. It's a little more significant on this slide than it was in the last slide. And we also have a new, our extended health, which is medical, dental, and, or sorry, our benefits, medical, dental, and extended health, dental, and life in this category, has gone up. So we have this item here that's being added this year, and it will become part of our overhead benefit that we charge on all salaries. So that is a hit to our budget this year. And then this category of others is all kinds of things. Some items are going down. There's in the case of 82,000, that's overtime across all of recreation services, right-sizing the overtime budget, facilities asking for additional salaries. So the others is sort of a lot of small items all coming together.
Councillor Richter?
Yeah, do we have any stats on usage of programs? And I'm thinking particularly in Parks and Rec. So we offer a lot of different programs. How well subscribed or well used are those programs? And is there any standard for what's considered well used?
I could ask Christine, or we can find out and bring that back.
Yeah,
we'll find out.
Bring it. Thanks.
Councillor Whitmarsh.
Thank you. just as you were talking, it sparked in thought in my mind. Under when you were talking about the other category, and you mentioned overtime. So these amounts of money, so that we do not have to have that overtime in the future, is that what that?
No, overtime is in some areas, and especially in recreation, their overtime is just a way of doing business. Like it's necessary, and this is just getting the budget to be adequate enough to cover the amount of overtime that's coming in. Definitely, they work continuously to try and find solutions to overtime.
Right.
But one of the solutions to overtime is hiring additional staff, so that often becomes a bit of a tug of war. So there's a little bit of that going on.
Right. So this number of 82,000 here. This is meant to hire additional staff so that we pay less in overtime.
It's providing a budget so that we're not going over budget by the amount of overtime that we're having to pay. So it is actually a budget for overtime salaries.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
So if we were to be able to accurately determine the amount of staff that we needed and could do it without overtime, that would of course bring a savings.
Yes.
Right. So is this at all attempting to do any of that, or this is not part of that conversation?
I think the departments try to do that always on an ongoing basis, but oftentimes, as I mentioned, it one of the answers to that problem is to hire additional staff. So sometimes it can't be fully eliminated.
Right.
But I don't remember the last time I actually have seen them increase their overtime. So it has been a while, and it is something that they look at ongoing.
Right. Okay. So this isn't extra amount of hours so that we can therefore decrease overtime costs and we see a saving somewhere else. That's not happening here.
No, this would just be to maintain existing service
okay.
levels.
Thank you.
Councillor Ferguson.
Okay. So I'm going back to your page 3 of our universal services in our document here. This one. And that's the page 3 is a 2020 versus 2019. So 2019, we had the, I call it the poll tax or employee health tax of 1.22%. Now, is that being rolled in consistently so we don't have to worry about any more increases on that?
I'll say that yes, off the top. However, this will be our first full year. 2019 will be our first full year with the employee health tax. We have been remitting it on the basis that is required by the provincial and federal government. So I will say it was rolled into the base in 2019. The increases that we should see now from now on are just the contract increases, the 2% contract increases.
Now, the 0.08, I think you explained that was benefits. That's yeah. Extended health. And that was something we didn't have 2019?
It's something that we had in our budget in 2019, but it's been increased by this amount for 2020.
And the cost of it. We are looking at the subtotals of 2.17% as compared to last year, 3.13%.
Correct.
So we went down a bit there. Thank you.
These are the pink are the sheets that show the operating amounts required to take care of the capital that we've constructed or contracted out. So this is what we call the operating budget impacts of capital, OBIs. And we've tried to provide the different projects so that you can see what these items are related to. And it looks like the largest one here is continuing on with our five-year plan to roll out the public space waste receptacles on the operating side. And then we have, what's the next largest one? There's a lot of small items. The 216th Street interchange with Highway 1. And not as big as installing a pump station, which is almost like a facility. So this one is a lot of smaller items. $468,325 is the total.
Councillor Whitmarsh has a question.
Just with regards to the public space waste receptacles, can you tell me what year we are in with the implementation?
I believe this will be the fourth year, correct? Third? Third.
Going into three. Okay, thank you.
And this is the operating impact of contributed assets that are coming from the development community, a little bit more on the user pay, on the utilities, property tax side than on the user pay. $140,000, these are full dollars.
I just have a Councillor Richter on the question.
Yeah, just going back to the operating income of capital, township capital, are all of these projects absolutely necessary?
Well, this is
some of them be dropped?
This is the operating component of projects that are either in progress and finishing in 2019, so they need the operating component in 2020, or items in the 2020 program that will be considered next week. So items that we've got inside the funding envelope, the operating impact is reflected here. So to the degree that we add or take away capital programs next week, this will change. This is the operating cost of the program, the capital projects that we'll be looking at next week.
Okay. And what's this PDD for Aldergrove Rotary Park?
PDD is Parks Development and Design, so that's the division, and it's just maintenance of the Aldergrove Rotary Park.
Thank you.
And now we head into the commitment to infrastructure and asset maintenance. So we currently have on the operating side, supported by taxation, we have a transfer to or a contribution to capital on the operating side of these amounts in the various divisions. So parks, transportation, and storm, 2.1, 2.3, 1.878. In the general fund, that includes the larger component of that is information systems, information technology, corporate administration on the land side. That's where the property acquisitions are, and then some small items in the other areas. But the two main items here are information technology and property and land. And this is the category that we spent quite a bit of time on in user pay utilities, and this is the property tax supported side, where these program costs are coming in significantly higher. And that's why we're highlighting them for you this year. They would have typically been included in prior years as non-discretionary. They would have been part of the 4.12% that we identified starting out. But as you can see by the amounts, we're showing them separately for consideration. And you might be saying, how could we have done $3.6 million in our budgets without these budgets, if it's important? And one of the answers is, well, there's two answers. One is that staff struggle to balance, to maintain existing service levels, which we've had quite a bit of discussion on. The second part is we've had some deficits in some of our divisions over the last two or three years that we hadn't seen prior to that. So transportation facilities, parks, we have seen deficits that our surplus has been enough to compensate for them. But it is a sign to us that we need to take a look at our budget, because we don't want a budget that an ongoing expenditure is being taken care of by a one-time source, which is surplus. And that is partly why our working capital surplus has decreased as well over the last few years. So this is very similar to what we looked at on the user pay side, only you can see the numbers are much more significant.
Just have a question from Councillor Arneson.
Yes, thank you. Could you just go back to the last slide, please, because it was talking about stormwater. So it's attributed $1.878 million. Could you just explain the degree to which that specifically refers to engineered stormwater management, like the infrastructure, the gray infrastructure, or does that include any of our other green stormwater management components that we have in the township? Do you know?
I'd probably like to defer to Mr. Seffi on that.
Yeah, thank you.
It includes all the components, Madam Chair, all the stormwater management components that we have. It includes all of those.
Okay, I guess I'm not clear in my mind, just because recently I listened to a webinar having to do with stormwater management and natural assets. So that's, I'm trying to clarify in my mind if this has those both components, or if it's just sort of like a mainstream kind of traditional approach to that.
It includes, if you mean maintaining existing natural areas, it does include that.
Oh, okay. Thank you.
Something you might have, if you just went to a seminar recently and it talked about natural assets, you could be talking about something that is on the forefront of local government right now, and that is actually quantifying the value of an asset provided naturally by nature as opposed to us having to build something.
Right.
So they're talking about now, if you have a berm that is protecting an area of land from not becoming flooded, there's a TCA or PSAB accounting process that we're going to have to be going through over the next few years in quantifying the value to us of that naturally occurring berm. If that berm didn't occur, what would we have to pay for a dam to hold the water back? So that is right on the cutting edge of capital right now.
Actually, the Suzuki Foundation was the one that co-sponsored this webinar, and there was a speaker from Gibson's who I believe have done a really good job that is used sort of as an example of how communities can create that kind of analysis. Because the other thing that occurred to me is that when you use natural assets as that kind of resource and you can monetize it, what it means is you don't have to maintain them in the same way that we do over time with the engineered infrastructure that we currently use from time to time, but primarily historically that's what we've used in the past. So it's just a different way of looking at that and potentially doing a cost-benefit analysis to see what kind of components we may wish to keep in our community just for that purpose alone.
Councillor Richter.
Under this, the next page, so the 2.72% or $3.6 million, I'd like to ask the same question that I asked about under the utilities, like what are absolutely critical things to be included here, like where we're dealing with matters of public safety? Yeah. Can we get a feedback on that?
Councillor Whitmarsh.
On this slide, when it talks about roads, is this for the building of new roads, or does this include the annual increase to the budget for paving that we had for $500,000? Or is this new road building?
This isn't new road building, but it's maintaining, it's all operating and maintenance costs to do with different aspects of roads. It's not the paving. The paving is separate. Some examples are some, illegal dumping, picking up illegal dumping cost, trip hazard program, cycling lanes, maintain the increased inventory, annual studies on certain aspects, street furniture, inspections, cleaning and replacement, aldergrove flower baskets. So it's a number of items that we take on and maintain and operate, but it's not capital.
Okay, so it sounds like it's more than just roads, the way that I might interpret roads.
Yeah, possibly this might have been a better case for the use of the word transportation. It's in the transportation division.
Okay.
It's quite a diverse group of things. Homeless camp cleanups, concrete repair.
Okay. Kind of okay, that's helpful. I was sort of thinking just purely a road, but it's more when you talk about baskets and cleanup.
Yes,
so.
Yeah.
Okay, thank you.
And so now this slide is meant to be equivalent to the one in the memo that was sent out showing the 4.12 at the bottom. So this is a little bit of a further breakdown of that 4.12. Not a lot more, but just a little bit more. So you can see the breakdown of that 4.12, which we're calling the base budget this year. It's a non-discretionary turn the lights on rollover from 2019 to 2020. This is what it would take. So we have the salary components, the salary annualizations. These are annualizations from the previous year. So you can see right here we have the RCMP one set out separately. We talked about the 560 a few slides back. That was just rolling the contract forward. This one is actually annualizing the two officers that were approved October 1st of 2019 in this year. And the salary and wages is annualizing other positions that were approved in 2019, rolling it forward.
It's a couple people who would like to... Sure. Okay, Councillor Ferguson.
Yeah, just a quick comment. I'm not sure if Council was aware when we were going through the process of having a double a tax, what they call property tax variance. That means two tax notices. That I didn't realize it was going to be 0.61% of our entire budget. And is that a one-time expense, or is that every year it's going to be that?
It's a 0.22 for that specific item. It's part of the 0.61. It'll be a one-time adjustment, and then our penalty revenue will hopefully stabilize. It will stabilize either at more than that or less than that, so we don't know for sure. It's just an estimate. Right now, our penalty revenue is $1.2 million, so it will either be $300,000 less or something hopefully close to that that we'll report back on next year.
I guess my only comment was at the time when we were, voting it or discussing it, there seemed to be a feeling that there would be a zero to minimal charge to the community. It's ended up being a lot more than that.
Yeah, it did mention the report. Maybe the two things collided, this item and the item that Councillor Long mentioned earlier about people who take advantage of a lower rate not paying their taxes as a way of financing. I do think that amount will be significantly less than this one, though.
That's what I thought,
yeah,
too.
Yeah. Those two things might have collided.
Councillor Richter?
Yeah, a couple of questions. Property tax shortfall for 2019, what's driving that?
So what that one is going back to last year, you might remember that Councillor Woodward already alluded to it. We had in 2018, we had a shortfall of our revenue from growth of $1 million. So we had anticipated a large, almost 3% growth level in 2018, and it came in at just over two and a quarter. So we had $1 million shortfall. So last year, I set the tax rate from growth to be 1.5, knowing that it was going to be more than that. But my hope was in 2019 that we would have enough excess growth revenue over 1.5 to offset the shortfall from the previous year, that they would net out and we'd be good. We got aggressive. The direction was to get a bit aggressive last year on our taxes. And so we moved the property tax growth percentage from growth up to 1.75 instead of 1.5. And we almost recovered the full $1 million from 2018. This is the amount we were short. So this is actually coming forward from 2018.
Hmm.
So we've done something.
So why does it have to be on this budget?
just anytime you're short in property taxes, that's your fundamental funding source that it will carry, it'll carry forward until we address it. So this is the year that we...
Okay. And the climate action operating requirements of 23.23%, we're getting a report back on that.
I've got a note.
And so it's could be discretionary, right? Depending on what's on that list.
Yeah, it's a list for council's consideration.
So these items, there are some in them that are discretionary and some that aren't?
We've treated it as maintaining existing service levels because when this report went to council, it was decided at that time, and anybody can change their mind, but it was decided at the time that the climate emergency items would be treated with a high level of urgency. So on the capital side, they're treated up with critical. And on the operating side, we've treated them as non-discretionary. So that's staff way of interpreting what we thought council wanted when they had the report on climate change at the CPC.
Okay, thank you.
I have a question. Property tax payable and land assembly, which land, and could you explain that one for me?
So this will be the large land assembly that we are buying currently. Because we haven't met the deadline to be exempt, we are normally exempt, but we're buying it from a non-exempt party. So we will have to pay the taxes in the first year, and then we'll be exempt from that
point. Okay. Yeah. Okay. Councillor Whitmarsh.
Yeah, thank you. I'm just wondering, just maybe for the future meeting, just to have a little bit more information about the external debt payments, like who are those going to, what is that, you know, just sort of break that out for council, I think would be helpful. It's a pretty large number, so just be helpful to know what the breakdown of that is.
Yeah, I can read it to you now, or I can bring it back. I have it here. So it's on the external debt side is 1.9 million borrowed for MAP. It's the strategic land acquisition, which is the large assembly that I just referred to. It's land acquisitions, which included Alder Inn, an LEC property, and an ACUCC property that were also done in 2019. And those three items make up the external debt that you see here. And the offset is a reduction in the transfer to the capital infrastructure renewal and replacement reserve.
Sorry, where's the offset?
The offset is the 2.218 million. That's in order not to have as large of a tax increase as it would have been. We reduced the transfer to the capital infrastructure renewal and replacement reserve to offset the strategic land acquisition.
Okay, the 1.66% negative. Okay.
It's specifically related to the large assembly.
Okay, that's helpful. Thank you. That's good.
Councillor Woodward.
Yeah, most of those questions that I had were answered. But in regards to the capital infrastructure renewal and replacement reserve offset, can you also break that out? Maybe send that along or provide that at some point. And then if you could itemize, too, the external debt payments. And now that those bylaws are done, each principal amount, the term maturity, I think it's in the first 5 years they're going to be maturing.
Ten.
Yeah. Okay. I thought we had the option to pay some of that down after a five-year. Okay.
So what happens is when we do our initial borrowing, if we do what's called temporary borrowing, not permanent, then that temporary borrowing exists to allow somebody to do like a progressive loan, so you don't have to pay the cost of the borrowing rate up front. You can draw it as you go. But if we keep the borrowing in the status of temporary, then you can keep it temporary for 5 years. So that's probably where the 5 year came from. And during that 5 year period, you can pay it back. You don't have to. You can, as much as we can pay off in that first 5 years, we can borrow less when we have to firm it up in year six.
Right, but we didn't do that, or we did do that, or
we're just in the process still.
Of still confirming that, because I think that maybe it wasn't 100% confirmed at the time, but the expectation, at least that I had, was that there was some opportunity to maybe liquidate some of those assets within that 5 year time frame rather than commit to a 10 year term.
Could be. Yeah.
So can you double check that for me and confirm?
We're in the 30-day quashing period right now, so it has gone to counter petition. It has been successful. We now wait for 30 days, and then
you're going to come back to us with some options around how to structure that borrowing.
The question will really be: do we want to go permanent or temporary? And what I'm hearing, it's going to be temporary.
So
that gives us the most flexibility.
Are you going to bring that to council for a decision?
Yes.
Or okay, so
not for a decision. My intention would have been to bring it to council as a temporary borrowing bylaw. Okay. Gives us the most flexibility.
Yeah, okay. So as long as we're... Because the five-year option may be applicable for some of those land holdings, right? May be very important to maintain. Okay. But I wanted to understand more thoroughly...
Can I carry on, Councillor Long? Or?
I'm talking about this council, not you.
So the capital infrastructure and replacement reserve offset, can you send that to us so we can understand fully what the opportunity cost of that borrowing is,
sure,
be able to communicate with that on that and maybe make some adjustments to that? All right, so I'd appreciate that. Thank you.
Karen, two follow-up questions.
Yeah.
The first one then is as to the property tax payable on land assembly. That would be a one-time, would it not?
Yes.
So we could actually move that to a one-time. That would affect the rate because this is being built in.
Sure. That's a good point.
For the term. And the second one then is on the capital infrastructure renewal and reserve. The number we provided earlier in the day, which I think was $8.9 million, was that net of this amount coming out, or was that was a transfer for the capital program? Did that amount have that deducted already, or did that still have to come out of that amount?
The $8.9
million for capital.
That's the operating contribution to capital?
Correct.
Sorry, can you ask your question one more time?
So is that amount coming off of that $8.9 million, or has it already been deducted, the capital infrastructure and replacement reserve for 2.28?
No, the 2.218 is coming off of the what would be a new debt payment.
So we'd be still solid at 8.9%, $8.9 million contribution to capital.
Okay. Councillor Woodward.
So can I have that clarified then, just to make sure, Mr. Bracken, that I fully understand where you're going with that. So the 8.9 versus, has it been impacted by the offset?
No.
It has not. No. So what would it have been without the offset?
It would have been right there. Where are we? 2.25% would have been the increase.
Yeah, it would have been more money, operating money going to capital?
To pay debt.
But if the debt wasn't there is where I'm going. So if the debt wasn't there, there would have been an additional 2.25 going to capital or not?
The
1.66 going to capital?
No. So
maybe Mr. Bracken can clarify.
But if we weren't using this fund to, reduce our debt payment obligations, we would have an additional 2.28 going to capital. So it'd be 8.9 plus 2.28. 2.218. So the 1.66 equates to a reduction in the capital infrastructure renewal reserve of $2.2 million. So if we take 8.9 plus 2.2, Karen, that's 11.1.
So there is a commensurate reduction to those reserves that we're still in good standing with those reserves, but we are choosing to contribute less in light of the borrowing?
We're electing to have either to transfer less to reserves or to have a bit smaller capital program so far. And why I say so far is, as was referenced, there's some non-discretionary amounts. There's a balance we have to yet to achieve. And in theory, one way would be to have a zero capital program that would generate $8.9 million additional revenue that would then probably give us a 0% tax increase, but then we wouldn't be able to, we have to shut down some facilities because they can't operate unless they're maintained.
Yeah, so that's why I think maybe I could take some extra time to break out that 8.9. Maybe that 8.9 become 7.5 without any significant impacts? That would be one thing to discuss and understand that breakout a little further before discussing it more. Thanks.
Councillor Richter.
Yeah, the service contract increases. Can you just remind me what's in that again? You probably already went through it, and I wasn't.
It's items that normally would have been included in non-discretionary, but they're programs that have gotten larger over the last few years. Things like homeless camp cleanups, trail trip hazards, street cleaning.
Can we get a list of all those?
Right here.
We got it?
Homeless camp.
Okay, but a breakout by each of them, like the costs of each of them. Because, again, the same question that I had before is what's related to public safety?
I had a question on, can we get a feedback on what's safe? Yeah, safety, right. Any other questions on this slide? So this is, again, a summary of the slide that we looked at a couple back, so I won't spend any more time on it. This is the program increases. This is our commitment.
Do you have a question from Councillor Richter?
Okay.
Yeah, I'd like to request the same thing as the other one. So in each of these, what's being proposed and what is its relationship to public safety?
Okay. Sounds good.
Councillor Davis.
Just to clarify that, that means that, like in roads, you had mentioned some of the things in roads.
Yeah.
Would that all be written down so we could see what consists of it?
Yeah, we can give a list of the items, the types of items in these categories.
Okay, thank you.
And then these are two asset categories, infrastructure and asset maintenance. So the first one is staff asking for an increase in the $8.9 million. So to go back to that base budget contribution to capital from operating, this is staff in these various areas saying, I know I have $8.9 million, but I'm asking for this much more in roads, facilities, storm, and parks to keep up with the capital program. Very similar issue to the operating side. So this would be added to the $8.9 million if it went forward. And it would show up as a funding source on the capital side. Currently, there's not any projects funded from this on the capital side. And then the asset maintenance side right below is where you see that road paving amount that was mentioned earlier. So two items in the area of asset maintenance, road paving and capital infrastructure renewal and replacement reserve. And I've got a question down here to get some background information on that second bullet.
Question from Councillor Richter.
Again, can we get a breakout? So roads, facilities, storm, parks, they all collectively want 1.8 million more? Am I reading that correctly? Yeah. Okay, again, what's related to public safety? Must be done?
On this item, it's a little bit different in nature in that this is not... this money is not being spent in the operating budget where public safety would be addressed. This is money that's being transferred over to the capital side to fund individual capital projects. There could be projects related to safety
on that
side as well.
Okay, but what projects are going to be funded by this?
Yeah, we'd have to. We can answer. We have staff provide the capital program in order of priority from climate critical, high, and on down. So we get to a point where we draw a line when we run out of funding. So this would take that line a little bit lower. So we could definitely do that. And this is a commitment to protective services, which we typically include RCMP and any bylaw officers that we have. So the request is for four. This is the first year of the 14 request for 14 officers over 5 years. So this is in October 1st, asking for four. This would be the cost. They'd need to be annualized in year two. And the senior bylaw officer, that's for a full year, is being asked for by ComDev.
Councillor Richter.
Oh, didn't turn off the...
All right. Councillor Woodward?
So the senior bylaw request, if that's approved, that would be immediate start as soon as it can be arranged.
Right now, that's being listed as of January 1st, yeah.
January 1st. So
there's already a little bit of savings.
Okay, so I'll circle that a little bit. And then the RCMP, the four officers, rather than me go back and look it up, I'm sure you just know what is the annual cost of one RCMP officer, full burden, all civilian, everything in?
It's $701 for the four, and it was $178 for one.
178 for one. So if I could use 178 for one.
Actually,
would that be?
Sorry, 175.
175. Okay. So.
175 or 178?
75. We showed it as 178 on the slide. So there's obviously a little bit of a disconnect. 175.
So I'll just put a range. How about that? So we have a 175 to 178 per annum. So if we were to agree to four, we're essentially pre-approving an additional 175 to 178 times four in the 2020 budget. Is that accurate to state
times
that?
Times nine. Because this is just going to fund October, November, and December. And then...
I was looking at it differently. I was looking at it as they cost me 175 per annum per officer.
Yes.
Regardless of what's on this slide.
Yeah.
So if I add four new officers, whenever they start this year, next year, presumably there's going to be four new officers employed and ready to go. Correct. Maybe not, but authorized right. strength. We're committing to an additional 175 times four for the 2021 budget. Sorry, that's probably where I confused you.
Yeah,
for the 2021 budget.
From 2020 to 2021, it will be the 175.
So we would be dealing with the normal service contract increases plus the addition of these 175 to 178 right. times four yeah. in the 2021. So to be a little bit careful about adding this, because if we're it's 0.013 in the 2020 budget, it's going to be more than the 2021 budget, right?
Right.
And so maybe you could just confirm that for all of us, that sure. that if we start looking at adding four this year and 15, you said 15 over five?
14 over five.
14 yeah. over five.
Chief Powers has, Superintendent Powers has said 15, so it may end up being 15. But right now, the submission was 14.
Okay. So maybe there's a plan that we could look at to say, you know, what kind of tax increase would we be committing to or pre-approving over the next 5 years per annum if we were to have a long-term plan and commit to that long-term plan as a council rather than revisit this issue every single year.
Yep.
That makes sense. So that's yep. where that information confirmed by you would be helpful for us to have that. Thank you.
Councilor Richter.
On the RCMP, so the four officers that are being requested, are they all going to be on the road in Langley Township?
I'll let Superintendent Powers
nodding. I think that means yes.
Can I answer all your questions from previous as well, quite quickly? They'll all be on the road in the township. That's where the demand is. I just want to go back to the comment by Councillor Ferguson about the nature of policing. It has changed dramatically. We do become more social in nature with our duties. The work that you see in the city also goes on in the township. Every Tuesday, our members are out with bylaws looking at homeless camps in the township to be cleaned up. The vacancy rate, to answer that question, as I wrote to last month, at any given time, we can have anywhere from single digits to worst case scenario double digit vacancies just due to transfers, promotions. It's almost impossible to have a full slate on board. Creekstone, there has been an increase for calls for service, and we are working with the business partners and the Creekstone staff as well to address those concerns full on. And I thought there was a fourth one.
I just have a question about Creekstone. Would you see those same calls elsewhere in the community now they're just over at Creekstone, or
is it
increased, or is it just now in one area?
No, it's a great question, because we did see a decrease over at the in and around the Gateway of Hope, and it has increased proportionately over at Creekstone. So we're trying to bring some order to the community. Just everybody's got a part to play here. So we've got a positive growth here, but now we have to deal with some behavioral issues outside of the building itself and sort of reestablish some ground rules for that community. Oh, township cars going into the city. The members that are assigned to the city work in the city. They work out of the city CPO, and the township, of course, work out of the detachment or one of the township CPOs. Unless there is a call for service, they pretty much stay in their zones. But they wouldn't, if there was a shooting or a serious incident, obviously they wouldn't stop at a border and look at that. And then the integrated units, for lack of a better term, and I'm not talking about the IHIT teams, integrated with regards to drugs, prolific offender suppression team, those types of teams within the detachment, which would be both township and city employees, members, they would work back and forth between both communities, and it tends to, and I keep a close eye on that, and there's no real correlation of one area being worse than the other. I think that the ratio of 75-25 works out for the time they spend in any given jurisdiction. So hopefully that answers all those.
We have questions. A question from Councillor Ferguson.
Yeah, thank you, Superintendent Powell. I just, let's forget about Langley for a second, call it Richmond, call it even Surrey. There was a time, and I don't know if there's any truth to that, that the folks that got what they call positioned in Surrey had a they pulled their guns more than they did somewhere in Push Cafe or something like that. The policing is different in certain areas. Been so in Richmond or something, I got Richmond RCMP. I mean, they have lots of people committing crime, mostly property crime. You know, I talked to all my friends and neighbors, friends that live in Richmond. You know, everybody's been broken into or almost broken into. And the policing has changed. It's just that whenever the question is, how do you monitor or audit, say, you know, what the role of a police officer is versus when it isn't. And those are challenges, I think, that you exist. And I don't know what the statistics are because it's just very complex. It's like a moving target.
Yeah, we have to adapt to community expectations, community demands, community public safety, and our ability to achieve goals. And we try to set our standards where we can be perpetually achieving some level of goals, making this community safer. The more low-level issues that we get to deal with, the better for the community, the better sort of assessment you could make of your community. When we're not running around chasing shooters all the time, then we can actually focus on car thieves and break and enter type people. So, and then, of course, as I said earlier, the social aspect is really starting to impact our time on the streets. So yeah, we do adapt perpetually. It changes, I would say, every 5 years significantly. So your point is well taken that there is.
You know, it's to say we're very, very happy with the work you folks do. And it's just, I really think that an officer, Officer George, who works in the city of Langley, today his role there is way different than it was 5 or 10 years ago. As compared to our guy who's working DW Poppy in the township.
Yeah. To a degree, I think they both changed. At the same rate, no, but they have both changed significantly. Like I said, more to, with the opioid issue, the mental health challenges, those are more front and center for our membership now in all communities. So I'm going to defend the city a little bit and say it's not as bad as you think, and this township's maybe not as good as you think. It's collectively the growth of our challenges there, but the same.
Councillor Richter?
I just had a question about the bylaw officer. So if there are other questions on the RCMP, the senior bylaw officer, will this person have some flexibility to take on special projects?
I will defer to Mr. Seppi.
Special projects, could I ask Councillor Richter to clarify or maybe expand?
Well, Councillor Davis and I had a meeting a week or so ago with an individual from Aldergrove who wanted to see some additional work done with bylaws in Aldergrove. I believe, we asked him if he would come and do a delegation to the next council meeting, which I believe he's going to do. But essentially, what we're probably looking at is needing some additional capacity within bylaws to do special projects. So I was just wondering if this position would have any additional capacity.
Madam Chair, this is requested to maintain existing service levels, I should say, based on the volume of work as well as some new programs, if you will, or initiatives, including parking regulations, including a number of different, as I said, initiatives and programs. Having said that, to the degree that council directs staff to undertake additional special projects, I think there may be some capacity, but I guess it depends on the specifics.
Okay, thank you very much.
Karen, just before you leave that slide, one very important thing I think that we wanted just to reiterate, and that is the annualization impact, for example, we'll say of the RCMP. If we look at this year's numbers, we note it's 2.17 as being the driver for salaries and wages, and built into that, I think, is 0.18 for the leap year. So if we take that out, we're roughly at 2%, give or take. The impact, though, of the four police officers, just to pick on them for a second, as you referenced, is basically to incur an expense next year, or in the 2021 budget, of $525,000, being that if it's four officers at $175,000, three times $575,000 is 5.25%. That would mean, and five and a quarter is roughly half a percentage of a tax increase. So that would mean we would start the year of 2021, assuming the contracts continue in the same range of, say, 2%, with an automatic increase of 2.5%. And I think that's an important thing to remember, that that becomes our driving factor next year. And that's the impact of the pre-approvals of the annualizations. It's just something very important, because if we set parameters through the process that are lower, let's say we set that we wanted to have a parameter of, we'll say of 2.5% would be our maximum that we would actually entertain. That means then effectively we're shrinking in other areas, which is fine, but it's a conscious decision then to actually shrink as opposed to continue to expand based on our cost drivers.
Correct. Oh, Councillor Richter?
Oh, I don't know why I had my...
Okay, so we'll clear it off.
And this is I think this is close to the last slide. This is the remaining discretionary item, second to last slide, that staff have submitted to the budget process. And so I'll just let you read that slide and take it in for a few seconds.
Councillor Arneson.
Yes, thank you, Madam Chair. I'm wondering, City Studio Township Initiative, I don't believe that there was any kind of descriptor of what that involves, Ms. Sinclair, so if you could expand a little bit about what that means under corporate administration.
Forgive me for reading. The City Studio concept is to develop trust-based relationships between municipal staff, students, faculty, and community stakeholders, and work together to tackle civic challenges and issues. By being involved in designing projects and co-creating prototypes and solutions, students are engaged and gain the skills needed to effectively contribute to real projects. Projects are generally oriented toward improvements that enrich neighborhoods and contribute to a more livable and sustainable community. City Studio involves a number of phases and economic investment and development proposes to host phase one in 2020, which would see the creation of the initiative and itself, the initiative itself, and licensing, as well as the discovery dialogues with fellow city studios in Victoria and Abbotsford. Engagement with educational institutions to develop partnerships and potential contribution funding would take place, as well as programs and guiding principle development. That's a short version.
Thank you.
Councillor Richter.
Yeah, did this ever come to council, this City Studio thing? Student project? Like, I'm not sure where this initiative's coming from.
Not yet. No, it hasn't come to council.
It hasn't come to council. Okay. But it's being put in the budget.
It's being just requested. This one is truly being requested as a discretionary item.
Okay. What I would like to request is a breakdown on all of these as to public safety.
I have a question about urban forestry technician. What are we doing right now, and what's the impact of the tree bylaw been on our bylaws, or do we have currently a urban forestry technician?
Yes, we do, Madam Chair. The impact is still being, analyzed, monitored in terms of how we are dealing with complaints and requests for permits. So it's still finding its level, if you will, in terms of the number of requests that are coming in.
Do we have people going out into the community and measuring trees and all that kind of thing as part of their permit bylaw?
Based on, follow up on calls and requests for service or complaints, yes, they do, but not proactively.
Okay. Thank you. No other questions I can see.
And this just identifies or highlights the 4.12 base budget changes, and then lists the other items that we've discussed that has we've received a number of questions that we'll bring back the answers to in the next council meeting.
Councillor Richter.
So if we add all these numbers up, that's where the 9.7 comes from, correct?
Yes.
That'd be correct, yeah.
That'd be correct, okay. All right. Thank you.
Councillor Woodward?
Yeah, so on the motion coming up on receipt or adoption, I mean, if we make no changes right now, we're headed for the 4.12?
If you were to accept the base,
yeah.
That's the 4.12, and then these items are to present staff and staff's professional opinion, what they say they need, and if you decide not to do it, then it would be 4.12.
4.12, yeah. Which is dropped now to 3.93.
Minus the 300,000, yeah.
Yeah, yeah.
That
so
sounds about right.
If we're operating from 3.93, yeah. Then it would be, I'm just trying to get to the baseline here. It's a little bit different than last year, where we started up high and then walked back. This one is a bit sort of in the middle, it feels like we're...
We were thinking of starting the other way, of trying this, identifying what is the non-discretionary base and then providing sort of a la carte items to consider of what to be
interesting
added.
To see how it plays out, because I guess if we don't increase the tax increase, then there'd be a lot of good stuff that isn't going to get done, right?
These items.
As opposed to asking us to which stuff we don't want to get done. You're now asking us which stuff we do want to get done. So be curious to see how that plays out. I had one question here somewhere. Could we also get the balances of some of these reserves? So I think I wanted to do a little bit more work on that this year, and that some of the accumulation of some of the reserves and what they're earmarked for. I would say things like, say, development fees revenue, is there money in that reserve? Or is there, like, say, building permit fees revenues, what's that at and where's that at? And then DCCs as well. And then maybe that's something we'll get to in part of the capital portion of the budget.
Yep.
Yeah, and then understanding maybe some of that contributions to reserves can be amortized a little bit further or changed somewhat based upon some of those balances.
Yep.
That would be helpful.
Sure. Okay.
Thank you.
Councillor Richter.
Yeah, so I just want to, the 9.7%, does that include capital as well, or will capital be over and above this
9.7%? The total of those items, the second item there, this includes all of the capital, to make a long story short.
Okay.
All of the capital that we talked about, the 8.9, in terms of what we contribute from the operating budget. There's other sources of capital that are not considered all in the operating budget, but we haven't touched the base 8.9 contribution to capital in this process. And in fact, we're asking for an additional 1.8. So we haven't taken it, we haven't rolled it back at all from 2019 levels.
All right, so how difficult would it be, and I'm assuming it would probably be fairly difficult, if we said we can't endorse a 9.7% increase, we want to see something more around 2-3%?
So we overall have to... to be a bit cautious, because that is making it sound like there's a recommendation for 9%. This is a total of numbers only. This is why we're having this facilitated session, to try to determine the priority, and that's a very good point, then what would be a range to work from within. But another example going another way might be, the council could say, well, this reference to a number of protective services officers, maybe we don't want 4 this year, maybe we want 14 this year, because it's part of a policy initiative to actually take a very aggressive position on some issues. That is one example of how the numbers could greatly change. And there's other initiatives that make them up from capital too. For example, there may be some desire to see a particular project advance that could take most of the capital funding if we chose to go down that path. I think our focus here is really on the 3.93, for example. If that number is the base amount, what do we wish to see happen with that? And that's a good suggestion, if the decision was to say, well, 3.93 may be the base amount you've come up with, but historically our long-term financial plan is 2.93. So as a consequence, then let's stick to the long-term financial plan and reduce $1 million then, roughly speaking, from the non-discretionary base. Now that would actually then precipitate some service adjustments, because you have to reduce $1 million in expenditures from the existing portfolio or the existing environment. That would mean we'd have to then have a hard look at, in terms of what could we either do to raise revenues. And one example might be, let's defer any suggestion of the tax penalty initiative, or what expenses could we actually eliminate, which could be a program. It may be, let's not do the grass cutting as frequently, let's do it twice a summer as opposed to three times a summer. Those are just examples of where we can go with this.
Yeah, well, we have to go somewhere with it, because 9.7 is, well, I mean, maybe we should have a vote on it right now. How many people here want 9.7? And how many people don't want 9.7?
Are we entertaining a motion?
No.
Okay.
But it is direction.
Can we get through this one?
Okay. Sure. Councillor Davis?
Oh, no, I just blurted out. Shouldn't have.
Maybe we can just get to the end and then put up for discussion.
So I believe this is the last slide. This is the last slide. So this is like the one times on the user pay side. This, what will be added to this list is the item that Mark mentioned, the 300,000 property tax that will be a one time. So this will be 2.8 million. These are the one time items that are being requested on the universal side of things.
I do have a question about the legal defense fund. What and how does that money get used? And is that something for 1 year, or is this something that we need for this year? And who's using that fund?
This is all 1 year. All of these items are one time. And
it'd be for extraordinary legal expenses we might incur. It represents only a reserve fund. For example, we do know that traditionally our legal budget has always been challenged, so it may be used to rationalize that, or there may be other events that have to be resolved that could be drawn upon from that fund.
Thank you. Councillor Richter.
Yeah, I'm going to be a little more pointed about this legal defense fund. What is it actually going to be used for? Is indemnification involved?
Part of it could be. We haven't got that far in terms of making any recommendations. It certainly could be, because it would be for legal expenses that were not annually budgeted for. But I think, to be fair, it would probably be for more than that, as throughout the years we've had additional legal expenses, even in terms of pursuing various properties in terms of for delinquent taxes.
Okay, and what about council priority planning?
So that item was originally put forward last year as $500,000 to deal with five different projects that were identified in the council priority setting session from last year. It was cut back during this process last year to $178,200, and I had a note to defer this amount to this year. So that's the balance of the $500,000. So it would be split against the four different projects that were in that planning session. Tree canopy, not very good. My memory's not very good. Tree canopy was one of them. Sorry, I don't have that at the top of my head.
And so 2.5 million, is it 2.5 plus one or point? 2.573 plus 0.514?
So the 2.573, first of all, will be 2.873, based on Mr. Backen's comment about taking an item out of the operating budget, because it's only one time. So it'll be 2.873, and that's coming from prior year's surplus that we're anticipating for 2019. And the 514,000 is coming from some reserves that were identified as funding sources for these four items. Non-stat reserves.
Councillor Woodward.
Yeah, thanks. So I just wanted, before, prior year surplus is always, it's always the more interesting one for me, but on this one, I just wanted to clarify. So you're showing us the list of items, and then they add up to a certain amount, as opposed to saying prior year surplus is 4 million and here's what we're spending it on. Is there more than 3.389?
There's not 1 cent more.
But you just added 300,000.
I'm just
like, without even thinking about it.
So we're going through the year-end process right now, but typically, We have been heavily reliant upon our prior year surplus for the last few years, to the point where we've brought down our working capital lower than it should be. We talked about that in the council priority committing session. So we are trying to be super conservative this year in our use of prior year surplus. Could there be more? If you asked me, if you said we absolutely have this $500,000 item and we absolutely have to get it done, I could probably be squeezed, but I'm just always... This year, I'm just really trying to be conservative on that issue.
You know what you just said, right? You just said you had 500 more.
200. it's a tough one for me. As Director of Finance, I'm not thrilled that our working capital is where it is, so I'm trying to work at bringing it back
so
up.
Council priority.
I understand the challenges.
Okay, so I just take that for what... So the council priority planning, I think I'm looking around the table here. I don't even know what that is anymore. So I don't know if we really need what that sounds to me like is a $400,000 council contingency, which sounds to me like we could probably flag that at least for further discussion to reduce that substantially or remove it. And then if we do spend some money, we can obviously just pre-approve it. So I don't know. Maybe we could look at putting that to something else. Retirements and overlap, that seems like a really round number rather than something more known.
Yeah. So what that item is recognizes that people like me are retiring in 2020. And there's a number of other people like me, and we're trying to provide for some overlap. So that's the name overlap, so that a person can come in a month or 2 months while I'm still here, and we can transition that way.
That's why it's not known, and you're sort of guessing it.
It's based
good
on
good guess, probably.
It's based on an educated guess of who it is.
Okay, that clarifies that. Bridge inspection program. The word program looks to me like something that would be ongoing as opposed to one time.
I accept that, but that's not the intent, so we can change the language, Madam Chair, through you to Councillor Woodward. The intent is one time. It is not a continuous program. But I guess in a few years, it will come up again. So it's something that we have to do from time to time to ensure the safety of our bridges.
Well, maybe maybe we could turn it into that with the $300,000 that we just pulled out earlier. Maybe we could look at implementing an ongoing amount of money every year to fund sort of bridge inspections, and then you can go about it without having to come back like this. Maybe I'm going to put a little note next to that.
Can I take an opportunity to identify this as a really good example of how we could end up with the list that we had of the programs, the $3.6 million? Mr. Seffi has mentioned that, you know, this one in particular is one time, but it could be that we do this every 3 years right now, and as we grow, it has to be done every year.
Why not fund 25 a year?
And then we bring it forward for council's approval to add it to the base. That's an example of how those can happen.
Yeah. So, I mean, I would look at that 25 a year, and we don't see it, or it just comes back every year built in, and unless something changes. Some of these other ones, I've got similar questions, but I don't know how much it really matters to get. A lot of these seem like capital projects that should be in the capital program with a priority assigned to them, and then we fund them or we don't. So LEC transformer, for example, and then some staffing positions that are temporary. Vector storage processing station, again, sounds like a capital project that should be ranked and then explained rather than just put in the prior year surplus with no rank and no explanation.
So the transformer is actually rental of a transformer. It's a temporary transformer while we're actually doing the capital project. There is a capital project related to that.
Okay.
This is just a rental of a temporary transformer.
Okay.
Until that project.
So then the storage processing station, same thing. You know, what storage is that? Rather than seeing it as a capital project that's ranked and explained, is sort of hidden in here. And maybe this is one of the flaws in not having the entire budget at the same time, is that I can't go and verify that for myself.
I'll confirm that.
Yeah, but if you could... Maybe there is some extra money here we can squeeze with some of these adjustments that I've outlined. And I didn't even mention the legal defense fund yet, which I'm going to do now. So, Mr. Backen, could you confirm if by the end of the council meeting on the 27th, we would know the status and the requirements of legal defense fund as confirmed and voted on by council?
I think you're talking about the indemnity issue, and to answer that question, yes, we'll know that. But the legal defense fund can include more than that, because we have had the challenges in the operating budget about always having insufficient funds budgeted. So rather than try to increase that, we're looking to try to streamline that. So there's a certain portion of this that would be appropriate to actually hold as a reserve to offset those going forward, so it wouldn't always be over budgeting those till we get a better handle on it. But as to your question for issues of indemnification, the council will be within having full information by the close on the 27th.
Okay, so we could flag this, and then we'd look and see what the amount actually ends up being. I think there's some assumptions being made here with seeing it the way it is. I'd like to have a full discussion about that. I think people's problems are their own, not necessarily the taxpayers. And then for $800,000, I mean, for my own education, how has that worked in the past in terms of setting up a legal contingency fund, per se, because you can't anticipate full legal problems? In the past, it has always been in deficit and then caught up, or has there been some reserve contingency types function just for my own education?
Past, I would say that it has... it's had its years where it's been very close and years when it's been in deficit, and that deficit then has come out of the overall operating surplus. What we're anticipating is some or all of this, more realistically, a portion of this could be utilized to actually be the offset itself going forward. But then it would remain as a carry forward until we actually had a better overall number. This is probably, again, without knowing the amount of indemnification that we've talked about, this is probably just a good breakdown in terms of what it could be, but there needs to be more work done.
So we could set up a reserve for legal and then have money in there and then have just replenish it every year rather than seeing it done like this? Is that something that would be beneficial?
It's a bit like the snow defense fund, if you will. Yeah. We have a certain amount allocated towards it, and quite often if the year is good, we carry it forward, and if it's a bad year, we have to augment it. But at least then we're not drawing from our surplus, because then in those situations, as Karen's pointed out, it can affect liquidity or it can affect our ability to do other capital projects.
All right, thanks.
Councillor Whitmarsh.
Yes, just for clarification, we've been talking on this item, this property tax payable and land assembly, which I think we keep using the number 300, but in the one on page 19, it actually listed at 250. Am I just confused on what number it is?
No, I was confused. I said I was thinking of it as a $300,000 amount. Okay. So you're correct.
It is the 250. Okay, yeah. Thank you.
Councillor Richter.
Yes, thank you. I'd like to request that we have more details on each of these. Like, for example, why are we spending $163,000 on admin support, $120,000 on business continuity plan? So could we get details of each of these as well as a ranking relative to public safety?
Yep. Councillor Davis.
Is it legal defense fund? Would that be an issue if it should stay in closed, or is that going to be a problem, or maybe it shouldn't?
The budget item can be discussed publicly. The individual elements we have to discuss in the closed, and that's what was being alluded to. We'll have a better sense of our position as to recent legal issues after the 27th.
Okay, thank you.
And that is it.
Okay. So we have two. We can receive and refer the 2020 Universal Services operating budget to a future special budget meeting of council for purposes of further consideration, discussion, and approval, or as received or amended. Do I have?
I'll move number two.
Councillor. Oh. Councillor Whitmarsh, do I have a seconder? The first one? Do I have a seconder?
I need to know what's going on.
Okay. In front of you on the top, the council. Okay. Councillor Davis seconds. Any discussion? Councillor Richter.
Yes, I'd like to add an amendment in there that staff work to reduce the anticipated tax increase from 9.7 to a maximum of 3%.
Do I have a seconder?
I'll second that.
Councillor Woodward seconds.
The only challenge is it said anticipated of something. It's totally in order to reduce it to 3%, whatever it may be, but we don't have it anticipated at this point.
Could we?
Yeah, but it's direction. We're giving direction.
Correct, but it references a number that's not accurate because we're not recommending it. It's simply a matter of the direction. It's quite appropriate to say that a tax increase of not more than 3%. It's the reference to the anticipated that's not accurate.
Okay, I'll remove the 9.7 and just say to a tax increase of not more than 3%.
Do I have a seconder?
I'll second it.
Okay, but we amended the... Okay, so Councillor Woodward seconds it. Any discussion? Oh, okay. It's Councillor Whitmarsh is first, actually.
I think, I appreciate the need to lower the number from what might be in here, even though there is no direction. This is just points for discussion. I think it's premature to identify the specific number for us to work towards. I think there's been lots of feedback given in the meeting today. And I would prefer to wait to identify a number if we're going to do that until we've met to the next special budget meeting, which both of these things are going to. So I would not support that today.
Councillor Long?
Yeah, well, I have the same concern because we're putting numbers out there that we can't really justify, even though they sound good and it would be nice, but how can you justify that number? Maybe it's 2.9, maybe it's 3.1. I mean, I'd be happy to ask staff to bring the number down, but I don't know how that wording would be. But I think that's kind of inherent. Yeah, I think we all know that we'd like to bring the number down, so I think I'm best not to support this. It's an amendment, right? Yeah. So I won't support the amendment, but as the original motion says, further consideration and discussion, so we can still work on it next time.
Okay, thank you. Councillor Woodward.
Yeah, no, I also support the mover's intent to lower the number, but I haven't even seen the whole budget yet, and I think I expressed some of that frustration a little bit in an email over the weekend. And it's only a minor amount of frustration. I would like to get the whole budget at once rather than sort of not knowing what's in the capital program. So I think I support the idea behind it, but I'd like to get the whole budget first before talking about referrals and motions to change numbers and so on. I'd like to see it all first and go from there. So I don't support it today, but I'd ask the mover to reconsider bringing that again to a further motion. Thanks.
Councillor Ferguson.
Yeah, thank you. And I also think if you would like to add on what my favorite is, what other communities are doing, because, you know, that does have a somewhat an impact, although that we do our, you know, we're responsible for our own budget. I think a little bit premature. I don't think anybody at this table wants a 9.7%. All that's been thrown around. If you add the numbers up, that's what it is. I think we have to, you know, decide for ourselves what we want to include in our budget and what we don't want to include. And the question has always been asked in the past, including last year, what did we want to take out? What did we want to defer? What did we want to change? What did we want to rent versus buy? What did we want to act upon and not act upon? What services and also what employees we wanted to add? So, I mean, there's a whole number of steps that we need to do before we move forward. It's our first day of budget today. I like more meetings and less meetings to go over more stuff. I think we've got, I call it flagged. I'm not sure what staff uses anymore. I call it flagged a few that we've done. So I think I can't support this right now, this amendment. But I certainly look forward to rolling up our sleeves and getting some answers to these questions and coming up with a better number percentage. Thank you.
Councillor Davis.
Yeah, you know, I think I'm just going to repeat everything. I like the intent of sending direction to bring it down, but I think that there is a lot of questions that we brought up, and we need to get some feedback from them. And I think that's what I like the intent of trying to keep it down and giving direction, but I think we've got to look at some things first. Thank you.
Okay, so I'll call the question on the amendment, and I guess this would be item B1, would you say?
Sorry,
okay.
Amendment or the motion?
On the amendment, I believe, right? Yes, okay, so. And it's defeated. Mayor Froese is not here. All right, so do I state who opposed? Oh, it was just Councillor Richter. Okay, so now on the resolution, do I have a motion?
So
the motion is there. Okay, so do I call the question? Okay, it's discussion. Okay, so discussion. Councillor Richter.
Yeah, well, I'm going to put another amendment forward, and that this be amended to bring back for further discussion a reduced tax rate.
And do we have a seconder? Councillor Arneson, any discussion? Councillor Davis.
Yes, I think that's more better language for me. I think that when it comes back, you're going to look for reductions, I think. Well, I think that would just be a natural thing, I would hope. Now that I've said that, sorry, it's going to come back reduced? Well, we can't. Can we do that?
Well, the question would be which area you'd like to see the reduction in, because we've broken it down. So it might be the base, it might be in the contribution to capital, it might be in some area in between, because we do know that a lot of the amounts that are going to be discretionary are not likely to be successful. But is there where you'd like to see a focus?
Yeah. Okay. Thank you.
Councillor Whitmarsh.
Yeah, I mean, today is the first budget meeting, and we're just getting information, being able to ask questions. And, you know, I certainly don't think there's anyone here on council that's suggesting that everything in here, which would add up to 9.7, is the way we should go. But staff hasn't suggested that. There's no direction that's been given. It's a list of items that we're looking at and discussing. And so I don't think anyone here is suggesting, yeah, let's just go for it. That's why each of the resolutions that we've looked at, the last one universal services, and then the one that we just did on user pay, that's why we've chosen the first resolution, because there's lots of discussion, there's lots of questions to be answered. And so, you know, there is no direction given. So to lower something that is lowering something of no direction, I'm happy with the motion as it is already. I think it makes sense for us to continue the discussion, and somewhere along the way, things will get lowered, because no one here is going to support, I don't think, a 9.7 anyways. And so you can't lower something that doesn't have direction. So I'm not going to support the motion.
Councillor Arneson.
Yes, thank you. I think on the basis of the earlier discussion right at the beginning of the workshop, more or less, from Mr. Bakken, is that this is an extraordinary situation in that this has been put forward within the context of staff not giving any particular direction at this time to council to endorse globally what this looks like, or, you know, to remove or consider or anything. So I think the wording of the amendment is important, because we are in effect just giving voice to what I understand is a consensus around the table, which is basically the amount that is added up cumulatively would be too much, but we are not going to mandate at this time what it should be, but we are wanting to reflect, which I think is fair to staff, that we want to look at a reduction of some type. We don't know what that is. And I think that it's important that every time we vote on something, it's really a reflection of the direction that we're giving. And so this gives more focused direction, I believe, based on the discussion today, that in fact, we don't know exactly what the number is, but we are looking for a broad-based reduction just for the purpose of making sure that we are not overburdening our taxpayers in 2020.
Councilor Richter?
Well, the reality is we've got two more budget meetings, January 27th and February 3rd. And between now and February 3rd, staff have to have some idea about where we're going with this. Now, the previous motion that I put on about not more than 3% wasn't palatable. And many of you around this table said you would like to see a reduced tax rate. You just don't want a number on it. And that's precisely what this motion says. And that's the direction we need to give staff, because staff are the people that we pay to bring us a budget and to come up with ideas around how we can make that budget work better. And I think if we vote down this particular amendment, I don't even see when we're going to have more time to discuss it. I just think that we need to be clear to staff, we're not happy with what we're reading today, and it's got to come down. And that's what this amendment does.
Councillor Long.
Well, I thought this was coming back for discussion, and we can have all kinds of motions could come at the next meeting. I'm not sure why we're continuing to drag this on, but unfortunately, staff are telling us, and we start off this meeting by saying, well, we don't want you to tell us where we're going to cut. We want it to be magically reduced. Staff are asking us again, if you want to entertain a motion such as this, where do you want to cut? And unless we extend the meeting for another few hours, I'm not sure where that is. But I assume that at the next meeting, we'll have a better idea, perhaps, where we can maybe cut. So we need to take what we've got here, digest it, come back on the next meeting and discuss it, which is what the motion says. So where I don't support the amendment, I certainly don't want people to think I don't want the taxes to come down.
Councillor Woodward.
No, it's not the same thing as before. It's not that I objected to the 3% so much. I just don't have the budget yet. I actually want the whole budget before we start talking about reductions or what we're going to do and how we're going to structure it, because I don't have the capital plan in front of me. I haven't, don't have it yet, don't know what it is. And the contributions to capital, I mean, I can take a closer look at those once we have the capital program. So I to send back saying reduce it, thinks to me we could definitely do that after we have the whole budget in front of us, which we don't. And so that doesn't change. And I'm hoping just before we move on after this is all resolved, that we're going to be able to talk about the timeline again to confirm how much time we may have, because maybe this motion is appropriate if this is somehow going to wrap up in 2 weeks. Thanks.
Councillor Ferguson.
Oh, can I have the motion read again, please, or amendment read again, please?
The motion reads that the budget be amended to bring back a reduced tax rate for further discussion.
Okay, well, the only thing I would say to that is the fact that, you know, echo what Councillor Woodward has said, that, you know, this is something that, you know, we need more time to analyze the commitments. I'm looking at the commitments on page 4 of the introduction, where the commitments to maintaining existing service levels, infrastructure, asset management, protective services, and other requests, as pointed out on one, I guess, one times. Anyway, yeah, so I think we still need to discuss more before we can ask staff how to do this. We need to give them direction. And I support the spirit of the motion, I think it's a little bit premature. I think maybe on next Monday might be more. And I think many of us have some homework to do as to, you know, what we would like to see looked at again. And we can do that through email or phone call or something else to staff between now and next week. So I'm not ready to support the amendment right now. Thank you.
Councillor Richter.
Yeah, I just want to go back to the budget timeline. We've got a meeting at the start of a full day of council meetings on January 27th. So are we going to, at the end of this January 27th, say to staff, bring us back a reduced budget? And they've got to have time to look at where to reduce, or are we not going to make that decision until February 3rd? And if we wait till February 3rd to say bring back a reduced budget, then February 10th and 11th are the open houses. You got to look at the timeline here, guys. Anyway, I think that staff need to have direction, and that's why I think this amendment needs to go through. And if you vote this amendment down, then I don't even know what's the purpose of having any future meetings.
So, I'll call the question. So B1. And it fails. How does that work? Oh, yeah, so it fails with Councillor Ferguson, Whitmarsh, Councillor Kunst, Councillor Woodward, and Councillor Long opposed. So now we go back to the main motion. So I'd like to call the question on the resolution. And it passes with Councillor Richter opposed. So do we have any other business? Okay, so Councillor Woodward.
So can we review the budget timeline one last time? Because maybe there's some way to squeeze some more time out of that. But if there isn't, there isn't. But I did look up the timeline last year, And we had both of them, I think, a little bit later than this, and we still had a bit more time than we're anticipating this year. Pull up last year's.
There were some significant, a few significant changes in when meetings were scheduled this year due to the family day and a couple of other items. Can I suggest that we take this away and send it out, or?
Because I think I'm just sort of just trying to help a little bit that I don't know how, as a counselor, I'm supposed to read the budget, digest the budget, and review the budget in 10 days when you've all had months to work on it. I don't know how I'm supposed to catch up in 10 days.
I think the request is actually to try to add a couple of additional dates for discussion or for presentation, something along that line.
Let me clarify the intent. Okay. Maybe that would be helpful. Okay. I think the intent is to have more than basically 7 days from the council meeting to when open houses proceed, because I think there's a perception in the public that the whatever shown at the open house is essentially being endorsed or all but endorsed by council. I don't know how we're going to get there with only one meeting, which is, I'm looking at the calendar, I think 7 days from when we actually have the budget in our hands to when we're discussing it again with one meeting scheduled before it's shown to the public for feedback. That essentially would prevent me from suggesting pretty much anything.
So effectively, if the open houses or public consultation was pushed back, that would probably provide the timeline? And then meetings could be fitted.
I don't have the council calendar in front of me, but maybe there's an opportunity to have council consider on the 3rd an additional meeting prior to open houses based on the discussion. At least have that option, whereas right now it wouldn't seem that we would have enough time to potentially look at an interim meeting between the 3rd and the open houses to potentially have some more discussion on the 3rd and some other items to discuss and adopt or reject before it goes to the open houses, if that makes sense, Mr. Bracken. What you're trying to achieve there is a bit more time to work through some of these issues with staff and get some more time to communicate directly with Ms. Sinclair on additional items like we did last year.
I think on the 27th we could bring back a revised timeline to allow for more time between council deliberations and the initiation of the public open houses.
Yeah, if you could have a second look at it, and then we could look at it again on the 27th, I'd appreciate that. Yeah, thanks.
As an example, last year what we did do is we bounced the results of the public consultation to the same day as the draft 5-year financial plan. That was not desirable, but that's what we did do last year.
I would agree that's not desirable either, and you'd have to look at the council calendar, I guess, and I can do that as well and see if there's some way to
push the open house.
If we need to schedule another special meeting, perhaps that's something council would consider.
Okay.
Do we need a motion for that, or can we just...
Well, it's just a request that we have some additional timeline, or an alternate timeline at the next meeting, and we can do that, and that'll give us enough time to flow it through a bit without having to check our calendars.
Councillor Ferguson?
My same comment. If there's an opportunity for us to meet more, we should make ourselves available. Thank you.
Okay. Any other business? Seeing none?
Terminate.
Motion terminate. Thank you. Councillor Davis, seconded by?
Long.
Councillor Long. All those in favor? There we go.